and those high-speed connections, and that's clearly expressed in the infrastructure investment plan.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes topical questions, and then brings us to the next item of business, which is Stage 3 proceedings on the Apologies Scotland Bill. In dealing with the amendments, members should have the bill as amended at Stage 2, that is SP Bill 60A, the marshalled list, that is SP Bill 60AML, and the groupings, SP Bill 60AG. The division bell will sound and proceedings will be suspended for 5 minutes for the first division of the afternoon. The period of voting for the first division will be 30 seconds. Members who wish to speak in the debate should press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible after I call the group, and I would be grateful if members could now refer to the marshalled list of amendments. I call Group 1, Power to Modify Legal Proceedings Covered, and I call Amendment 1 in the name of the Minister, which is grouped with Amendment 2. And I ask the Minister to move Amendment 1 and speak to both amendments in the group, please, Minister.
Presiding Officer, I'll speak briefly about Amendments 1 and 2. The Scottish Ministers, under Section 2, Subsection 3 of the Bill, have the power to modify the exceptions in Sections 2, Subsection 1 and 1A by way of regulations. The two proposed amendments are technical in nature and are intended to provide clarity and certainty as to the Scottish Minister's power to make regulations. As the proposed amendments relate to the power to make subordinate legislation, we have written to the DPLRC to explain both amendments. Amendment 1 simply clarifies the power that the Scottish Ministers have to modify the exceptions to legal proceedings covered by the Bill in Section 2 by way of regulations. This amendment makes it absolutely clear, for the avoidance of doubt, that the Scottish Minister's regulation-making power includes adding to, removing or amending the exceptions in Section 2, Subsection 1 and 1A. It does not extend the power of Scottish Ministers under Section 2, Subsection 3. It merely clarifies the scope of the power which is agreed between myself and Ms Mitchell. The effect of Amendment 2 is that the Scottish Ministers, when making exceptions under Section 2, Subsection 3, may make transitional, transitory and saving provision to cover situations where proceedings have begun before an exception is created by regulations, or if an existing exemption is removed by regulations, to allow proceedings begun before the exception is removed to continue to apply the law which was in force at the time they began. The purpose of the amendment is therefore to provide legal certainty and flexibility. I move Amendment 1.
Thank you. Call Elaine Murray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and to thank the Minister for bringing forward these amendments, which Amendment 1 does indeed clarify the purpose of exception, and obviously as legislation is passed in future parliaments, the list of exceptions may need to be varied, exceptions may need to be added or removed. In terms of Amendment 2, which we would also support, I just wondered if we could have a little more clarification from the Minister as to the difference between a transitional and a transitory provision. Perhaps he can give some examples to when a provision may be transitional as opposed to being transitory.
Thank you. And I now call Margaret Mitchell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like again to take this opportunity to thank the Minister and these officials for working constructively with me to reach a stage where I believe we will have an amended bill which should meet both our broad aims. The Minister has already spoken to both amendments, and I have little to add. The two amendments are technical in nature and aim to provide greater clarity and certainty about subordinate legislation powers set out in Section 2. Amendment 1 relates to the power to modify the exceptions and clarifies that the term modify covers adding to, removing or amending the exceptions in Section 2.1. I'm happy to support the amendment. The second amendment extends the scope of Section 2.3 regulation-making powers to allow any such regulations to include transitional, transitory and saving provisions. And I think there's an issue there about before the legislation and after, which maybe the Minister will clarify. Under the bill, as it stands, the only power to make transitional, transitory and saving provision is as part of a commencement order under Section 5.4. That's fine if a change to the list of exceptions is made before the Act as a whole comes into force, but there may also be a need for transitional, transitory or saving provisions if the exceptions are modified later after the Act is fully in force and the power to make commencement orders is no longer available. Amendment 2, therefore, covers an important gap. I've always considered it important to ensure this legislation can be developed over the longer term, including, I would hope, at some point of time in the future, perhaps reducing the number of exemptions as the legislation beds in and proves its worth. It is therefore important that ministers have sufficient flexibility and power to modify the exceptions whenever the need for these changes arises.
Thank you. I've had two slightly late bids, so before I call the Minister, I will call the members. Annabel Goldie.
Deputy Presiding Officer, thank you. This is de minimis. It's just a point of clarification. In Amendment 2, can I ask the Minister to confirm that in the fourth line from the end, where the word proceeding occurs, I presume that should be in the plural and be proceedings?
Thank you. And the other bid no longer wishes to speak. So I now call the Minister to wind up, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Certainly, in regards to the issue of transitional, transitory and savings provisions, an Act of the Scottish Parliament amends the law. In most cases, it also requires to make provision for the transition from the pre-existing law to the new law when it is fully enforced, for example, to deal with cases which are underway when the new law is commenced. And the purpose of such a transitional provision is to facilitate the change from one statutory regime to another. The purpose of a savings provision is to narrow and exclude the application of new law so as to preserve the effect of a pre-existing legal rule, certain cases or circumstances. So I hope that makes clear at least what the transitional arrangement is for. In relation to the point about proceeding that Annabel Goldie raises, I believe that that she is correct, but I will check that with officials and respond in due course.
Many thanks. The question then is that Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. In which case, I call Amendment 2 in the name of the Minister, which has already been debated with Amendment 1, and I ask the Minister to move formally, please.
Formally moved.
Thank you. Question is that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. And that ends consideration of amendments. And that then brings us to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 15144, in the name of Margaret Mitchell, on the Apologies Scotland Bill. Could I now invite those members who wish to contribute to this debate to press the request to speak buttons now, please? And I call on Margaret Mitchell to speak to and move the motion. 10 minutes, please, Ms Mitchell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is with great pleasure that I open today's Stage 3 debate on the Apologies Scotland Bill. The bill was introduced almost a year ago on the 3rd of March 2015. However, the idea for the bill came as far back as April 2010, when Professor Miller came to speak to the cross-party group on adult survivors of childhood sexual abuse and told them about apologies legislation, which ensured that an apology could be given without fear of it being used as a basis for establishing legal liability. After some research looking at the legislation from other countries, I remember meeting with the Bill's team in 2012 and waving the one-page British Columbia bill, saying, this should be pretty straightforward. 4 years later, here we are, finally at, hopefully, the finishing line. Stage one consideration was completed on the 27th of October 2015 during a positive debate, an agreement on the Bill's general principles, but with caveats from the Minister, the Justice Committee and other contributors about the necessity for amendments at Stage 2. Here I would like to express my sincere thanks to both the Minister and his officials for their willingness to work with me in order to find common ground and a positive and constructive way to proceed. As a result, when the Justice Committee considered the bill at Stage 2 on December 8th, a number of amendments were tabled and agreed, either by myself or by the Minister and supported by the Committee. I also want to thank the Justice Committee for its considered scrutiny of the bill and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee for its consideration of the subordinate legislative powers. There are others who have worked to support me in making my case for the bill, to whom I will refer and thank in my closing remarks at the end of the debate. The Stage 2 amendments were critical to the passage of the bill. Before I focus on some of the key changes arising from Stage 2, it would be useful to recap on its objectives. First, to encourage the use of apologies by providing legal certainty that an apology in certain civil proceedings cannot be used prejudicially against the person who gives it. And secondly, to encourage a change in attitudes towards apologising and a cultural and social change in relation to giving apologies in an effort to give complainers closure. Section 1 covers the effect of an apology in legal proceedings and provides the apology will be inadmissible in certain legal proceedings which are set out in Section 2. I wanted to keep the bill as simple and straightforward as possible, and for that reason, Section 2 of the bill originally set out, in the broadest terms possible, that the bill would apply to all civil legal proceedings with two exceptions, namely defamation proceedings and fatal accident inquiries. During Stage 1, however, it became apparent that there were further types of procedure which witnesses and respondents considered should be included as exceptions. The first additional exception was in relation to inquiries held under the Inquiries Act 2005. Here the argument is similar to that which applies to fatal accident inquiries, in that as the inquiry's purpose is to establish the full facts, an apology should be admissible as evidence. I also sought and received the Minister's assurances the new exception would not affect the historic child abuse inquiry, which has no power to determine liability. Instead, it's a fact-finding exercise which seeks to establish a comprehensive picture of the events, to address public concern and to help restore public confidence in systems or services by making recommendations to prevent recurrence. As such, in this context, it is in the public interest for this evidence to be heard. The Minister lodged a further amendment to allow apologies in proceedings under the Children's Hearing Scotland Act 2011 to be relied upon as evidence in proceedings before Children's Hearings Panel and the Court. Having had discussions with representatives from the Scottish Children's Reporter Administration, I recognise that these hearings are complex in nature and may in some instances cover quasi-criminal issues and decide issues relating to appropriate measures of supervision and protection. I was therefore persuaded that court proceedings under the Children's Hearings Scotland Act 2011 should be added to the exceptions to the Bill's application. Turning now to the discussion surrounding the duty of candour procedure to be enacted via the Health, Tobacco, Nicotine, etc. and Care Scotland Bill and the provisions in the apology bills. An apology made under the duty of candour procedure in the Health Bill would not in itself amount to an admission of negligence or breach of statutory duty, but would be admissible and could be founded on in legal proceedings. It is, as the Justice Committee noted in its Stage 1 report, difficult to see how my bill and the duty of candour provisions could coexist without the form of exception which the Minister subsequently lodged. While I remain unconvinced about the effectiveness of the duty of candour, I do recognise the Government's intention to proceed with this provision, and I was therefore content with this amendment. However, I fully... moving now on to Section 3, which set out the definition of an apology and originally contained statements of fact and admissions of fault, which were included to encourage the fullest possible apology. However, I fully understood, recognised and accepted the concerns expressed by witnesses, including the Minister, that the inclusion of statements of fact could potentially prevent the individual from securing compensation where a statement of fact within an apology was the only evidence available. An admission of fault is not the same as an admission of liability. However, I ultimately recognised that this is a technical legal argument, and at this stage in the introduction of apology legislation, it was regarded as a step too far. I was therefore content with the Scottish Government's tabled amendments removing statements of fact and fault at Stage 2 in an effort to allay concerns that the bill, as originally drafted, could result in unintended consequences, potentially resulting in an injustice to some pursuers. The bill, as finally amended, now provides that in certain civil proceedings, an apology which expresses sorrow or regret about an act, admission or outcome, or which may contain an undertaking to look into the circumstances leading to the act, omission or outcome, will be inadmissible. The commitment by the apologiser to carry out a lessons learned exercise is, I believe, crucial to give closure. Section 5 of the original bill set out that the act would come into force at a fixed period of 6 months after a royal assent. The Minister's Stage 2 amendment changed the commencement of the Act from a fixed period to a commencement by way of regulations. I sought and received a commitment from him that this additional flexibility was not intended to and would not result in a significant delay in commencement. It's important to stress, Presiding Officer, the bill does not prevent anyone from pursuing legal redress, but it should help avoid those for whom an apology in itself is the desired outcome, having to take legal action or make a formal complaint in order to get this apology. By clarifying the legal status of an apology as defined in the bill, it aims to encourage their use at an earlier stage. Whilst legislation alone will not break down the barriers to making apologies, it can help to change the culture of reluctance to give an apology for fear of litigation and to encourage timely, appropriate, meaningful and sincere apologies. In conclusion, I very much hope that the Scottish Government will take on board both the need for guidance on implementation of the legislation and the importance of training for, in particular, frontline staff in both public and private organisations, and that this can be taken forward as part of its preparation for commencement of the legislation. Presiding Officer, I thank all those involved in the scrutiny of the bill and move motion S4M 15144 that the Parliament agrees that the Apologies Scotland Bill be passed.
Many thanks, and I now call on Paul Wheelhouse. Minister, 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start by thanking Margaret Mitchell for introducing this bill and for all the hard work she has put into it and the dedication she has shown throughout. I know that taking forward a member's bill can seem a daunting task, and I hope that ultimately Ms Mitchell and her team take satisfaction from her having achieved a positive outcome today. Although we have at times viewed the issues from different perspectives, we have always agreed about the value of giving and receiving of apologies and the importance of promoting a social and cultural change in attitudes to apologising, particularly within the context of public service provision. And I am pleased to be at a point today where I can confirm the Scottish Government's continued support for the bill. I would also like to, for my own part, to thank members of the Justice Committee for their hard work and careful scrutiny of this bill. And I would also like to thank the organisations and individuals who provided oral and written evidence to the committee, as well as those who provided briefings for parliamentary colleagues or engaged in the bill process in other ways. In particular, as Margaret Mitchell did, I would like to sincerely thank the survivors of historic child abuse who shared their thoughts on the bill. I'd also like to thank the Scottish Human Rights Commission and Professor Alan Miller, who I know Ms Mitchell has been working very closely with during this process. As has been made very clear during the bill's passage through the parliamentary process, apologies have the great value of acknowledging that something has gone wrong and demonstrating that lessons have been learnt. We all know mistakes happen. That is a sad fact of life, and these mistakes can often have tragic and long-lasting consequences. But it is how we deal with these mistakes that makes the difference. An apology can be a way of showing acknowledgement, respect and empathy for the other person. And while it cannot undo past actions, if done sincerely and effectively, it could provide some form of redress and perhaps give closure to those affected. It is clear that legislation alone cannot remove social barriers to apologising, but I believe this bill is an important step in changing attitudes in relation to apologies. Survivors of historic child abuse have been at the heart of the development of this piece of legislation. We have heard from many survivors about the importance to them of hearing an apology. The Scottish Human Rights Commission recognised this in their action plan on justice for victims of historic abuse of children in care, and full consideration of the merits of an apology law was one of the commitments that came out of this action plan. It's important to note, as the Scottish Human Rights Commission has pointed out, the present bill is only one of a number of measures to support survivors of historic child abuse in Scotland. The Scottish Government has demonstrated its commitment in this area by establishing the Historic Child Abuse Inquiry that Margaret Mitchell referred to, and by making clear our intention to remove the 3-year limitation period for cases of historic child abuse that took place after the 26th of September 1964, with earlier cases being affected by the law of prescription. At stage one of the parliamentary process, there were particular concerns regarding the definition of an apology in the bill, as Margaret Mitchell alluded to when it was introduced. It became clear the wide definition, which included statements of facts and admissions of fault, could end up disadvantaging pursuers who would be unable to draw on potentially important evidence. Concerns were also raised regarding certain civil proceedings where the apologies bill would not work effectively, and Margaret Mitchell has covered many of those. Because of these serious concerns, I initially saw benefit in an alternative approach which would put the common law in Scotland on a statutory footing along the lines of Section 2 of the Compensation Act 2006 in England and Wales. Having discussed further with the member and reflected on the evidence at Stage 1, though, my officials and I undertook additional work into the impact of the bill, in particular to try to ascertain whether, by removing fact and fault from the definition, this would alleviate concerns about any potential injustice to pursuers. I listened carefully to stakeholders and was persuaded that if the definition was amended to remove fact and fault, the access to justice concerns could be addressed. At Stage 2, I therefore put forward an amendment to remove fault from the definition alongside Ms Mitchell's own amendment to remove fact. And these amendments, as well as some amendments for further exceptions and some technical amendments, were agreed in the Justice Committee at Stage 2 on the 8th of December. The two amendments put forward and agreed at Stage 3 today, as we just heard, will clarify the Scottish Minister's powers to make regulations under Section 2, Subsection 3, and provide flexibility as to the application of the exceptions by means of transitional, transitory and saving provision. I mentioned earlier about concerns that were raised at Stage 1 regarding the effect of the bill on health professional regulators, such as the General Medical Council, or GMC, and the Nursing and Midwifery Council, or NMC. The committee heard from these regulators about the potential unintended consequences of preventing apologies being used as evidence in their fitness to practice proceedings, which may impact on their ability to assess the risk that a doctor or nurse may pose to the public in future. My officials have been working closely with the NMC and the GMC to find a solution to their concerns. It is clear from these discussions that an exception for civil proceedings undertaken by health professional regulatory bodies is needed. However, more work is still required to establish exactly what form such an exception should take. I would therefore like to take this opportunity to state my intention to use the power of Scottish ministers outlined in Section 2, Subsection 3 of the Bill to add an exception for proceedings held by health professional regulators once this additional work has been concluded. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I'd like to reiterate my sincere thanks to Margaret Mitchell for proposing this bill, for working very constructively with the Government and my team in doing so. I am pleased to be at a point today where I believe we have a bill that can make a difference to attitudes to apologising in Scotland and to deliver the culture change the Member seeks. And I commend this bill to Parliament. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And I now call on Elaine Murray, around 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There's probably not a great deal more that can be said about the short bill at this stage. That's not already been said, so I apologise for any repetition. Margaret Mitchell is to be congratulated in bringing her member's bill to this final stage. Shortly, I'm sure, to become law. This is an achievement for any member who undertakes all the additional work a member's bill requires. And Margaret is also to be congratulated for being prepared to listen to and take on board concerns and suggestions made during the Stage 1 process. She and Scottish ministers have worked together to overcome these issues and produce a final bill that I think has cross-party support. Margaret Mitchell has described to us what motivated her to introduce this legislation as convener of the cross-party group on adult survivors of childhood sexual abuse. And the process she has described, I think, in turning matters discussed by a CPG into legislation which is likely to be passed today, testifies, I think, to the importance of procedures in this Parliament which enable the concerns of citizens of Scotland to result in legislation. And we do hear a lot of criticism about the committees and so on of this Parliament. I think it's worth noting when our procedures work well and produce good legislation. I'm sure we've all had experience of constituents who have suffered some form of misfortune at the hands of public or private sector organisations and have felt aggrieved that they have not received so much as an apology for the distress caused to them. Sometimes an apology is all the aggrieved requires. On other occasions, they need to know that action will be taken to prevent the mistake occurring again, and that others will not have to go through the circumstances that they have gone through. And a meaningful apology for harm done can be of great psychological and emotional benefit and may sometimes be more helpful than any other action taken. But despite this being a short bill and its intention being widely welcomed, the bill as drafted at stage one did raise a number of concerns. There was a general consensus that removing the fear of civil action would be very valuable, but many witnesses were concerned at the wide scope of its definitions and the way in which it would work, and we've had mention of the way in which it interacted with the General Medical Council standards and the duty of candour in the health bill. And concerns were also expressed that the bill could have had unintended consequence of disallowing information relevant to subsequent civil action and thereby depriving victims of compensation. A fairly small number of amendments were unanimously agreed at stage two, which removed these concerns. These involved narrowing the definition of an apology. That may have been disappointing to the member in charge, because I know she did want to have the fullest possible definition of an apology. However, an apology is now defined as a statement indicating that a person is sorry about or regrets an omission or an outcome and undertakes to look at the circumstances which had given round to the matter for which the apology is being given with the intention of preventing reoccurrence. Arising from stage one evidence, certain legal procedures were removed from the scope of the bill. Fatal accident inquiries are now exempted, as these are not concerned with liability, but with understanding what has happened, with the sheriff making recommendations about how the death could have been prevented. An apology may be an important piece of information in understanding the cause of death, and therefore it should be admissible as evidence to an FAI. A similar argument applies to public inquiries set up under the Inquiries Act 2005, which also held to establish the facts and to restore public confidence. Proceedings under the Children's Hearing Act 2011 are also exempted from the definition, whether those proceedings are held before a court or a children's hearing. This was strongly advised by the Scottish Children's Supporters Administration in written evidence. The SCRA felt that there could be serious implications for child protection and youth justice if apologies given in respect to these matters, were not able to be included in the children's hearing. For example, if an apology for a harm done to a child may well be relevant to the actions which needed to be taken to protect that child, so it's important that those are not exempted. The Minister introduced two further minor amendments today, which enable Scottish Ministers to vary or remove exceptions, as well as to add to them and to clarify that they can regulate a transitional, transitory or saving provisions. And the Minister did explain to me what a transitional provision was. He didn't actually tell me what a transitory provision was. So I still remain consumed with curiosity as to a transitory provision. I actually was tempted to say we wouldn't support those at stage three so we could actually buy ourselves another 5 minutes of time, but I think that would have been a little silly, and I'm sure that the presiding officer would not have agreed to that. The Association of Personal Injury Lawyers and the Forum of Insurance Lawyers gave evidence at stage one advising that we didn't have a particularly litigious culture. And I think that's a good thing, but Margaret Mitchell did observe actually an apology could also reduce the number of complaints made to organisations such as the Scottish Public Sector Ombudsman. And that would actually be of benefit, not just to the SPSO in terms of effort and time, but to the organisations being complained about and indeed to the complainer themselves. And I would like to conclude by thanking the clerks, Spice and the witnesses who gave evidence, and to congratulate again Margaret Mitchell on piloting this bill through Parliament also to the Scottish Government for their assistance in the modifications of this bill, and I wish the bill well when it is enacted.
Many thanks. And I now call on Gavin Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too want to begin my speech by congratulating Margaret Mitchell on bringing the bill forward, and thanking to the Minister, the Justice Committee and all those who gave evidence to get us to where we are today. I have to say there was a time a couple of months ago where I wasn't quite convinced that we would end up with the bill that we've ended up with today, when the driven passion of Margaret Mitchell met the caution of the Minister. I had a minor fear, albeit a minor one, but a minor fear that we could end up with a bill that was utterly toothless and not worth the name, or we could end up in a situation where both parties walked away and we ended up literally with nothing after all of that work. But I think the actions of both the member promoting the bill and the Scottish Government have to be praised in the highest order, because they have met regularly, they have talked through issues, they have explained very carefully the positions they've taken and why they've taken them, and I think both sides have been pretty consensual in trying to make sure that we genuinely ended up with something that the Parliament could be proud of. We had a useful debate, I think, at stage one. We had some helpful amendments at stage two, and that consensual approach was typified all the way through the debate, all the way through those stages, to an extent that at stage three we end up with a mere two amendments required, neither of which prompted any genuine debate and neither of which were opposed at all. And I suspect and obviously hope that will be the case when it comes to decision time today. Just on a personal, I noted also the Minister's approach. He did listen carefully too, because at stage two there was an amendment he was proposing to lodge that, in my view, may have diluted the clarity slightly, but he listened to arguments from a number of committee members and took the decision not to move that amendment, which to me I think typified the approach of all parties towards this bill. So it's not hugely different, I guess, from stage two, but it is, I think, different from stage one in terms of the bill we've ended up. But what has changed? Firstly, we have some more exceptions to the Act which have been gone through. The inquiries under the Inquiries Act have been excluded. Children's hearings, have we heard, have been excluded. And apologies under the duty of candour procedure have been excluded too. I think there are good and sensible reasons behind each of them, particularly in the last one, where I think it was pretty obvious that they couldn't both have coexisted. The interaction, I think, had to be looked at carefully, and we had to be absolutely clear that there were no unintended consequences, and I think we probably comfortably are at that stage now. I noted the Law Society's response to the to members in advance of today's debate, where they seemed to accept the general principles of the bill and didn't raise any additional issues on a very short report, which was pleasing, I think, to see. And I think we have promoted the balance between promoting apologies and minimising those unintended consequences. The other major change, as I think we've probably heard already, was just a slight narrowing of the definition of apology. And I know Margaret Mitchell initially wanted it to be as wide as was feasible, but she again listened pretty carefully, and we have ended up, I think rightly, at a position where we have removed statements of fact from the definition, and where we have also removed admissions of fault from the definition too. The Justice Committee looked at it over a period of months and did state pretty clearly in the conclusion that the definition of apologies must be reconsidered. And the member, I think, promoting the bill made it clear that she was perfectly prepared to reconsider. She made it clear as early as stage one that she was going to do so. Had we stuck with the original definition, I think we probably would have ended up much further than comparable apologies legislation. And so, again, I think we probably ended up at the right place today. We didn't want to disadvantage or prejudice any potential pursuers. And, Presiding Officer, this, when we come to the end of today, will mark the end, I suppose, of the legislative process, but actually it's even more important what happens after that, because it's all well and good passing legislation, but if that legislation doesn't achieve the cultural change which we all want to see, then its value is greatly diminished. So we will have to, I think, as a number of members have touched on, make sure we get the right training so those who are involved at the front line can do their jobs correctly. We need the right amount of guidance to be published so that we make it easy for those on the front line to be aware of the legislation and to know how they ought to act, so that we get, in a couple of years' time, or when we look back, I should say, in a couple of years' time, we can all say we passed the right piece of legislation, it made a difference on the ground, and we actually achieved what we wanted to achieve right from the beginning. Thank you.
Many thanks. We now come to the open debate speeches of around 4 minutes, please. I call Roderick Campbell, to be followed by Margaret McDougall.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I first of all refer to my register of interest as a member of the Faculty of Advocates? Charles I is reported to have said, "Never make a defence or an apology until you're accused." And of course, he had an unfortunate fate. Perhaps he made his apology a little too late. But perhaps in turn we should follow the lead of the cyclist, Greg Lamont, who also in difficult circumstances is reported to have said, "More people should apologise and more people should accept apologies when sincerely made." Whatever the merits of an apology, I think we should recognise that the bill, following in the footsteps of other jurisdictions, is a step forward. And as many have said, and indeed said earlier today, it's not about changing the law, it's about changing the perception that you cannot say sorry. As we know, for many individuals who suffer some calamity in their life, often particularly in what could be described as issues of minor injury or distress, often they're only looking for an apology, and the failure to provide one often simply inflames matters. Changing the culture is therefore to be commended. Presiding officer, the member in my view is to be congratulated for listening to the views of others, not least the views of the Scottish Government itself on ways in which this bill can be improved, on the need to remove the reference to statements of fact, on excluding fault, and importantly on recognising the need to provide an exclusion for the duty of candour provision proposed under the Health, Tobacco, Nicotine, etc. and Care Scotland Bill. We heard a lot of evidence at stage one of this bill, some of it quite memorable. For example, on the inclusion of a statement of fact in the original bill, Mr Stevenson, the Faculty of Advocates, it may be recalled, said, "Why include a statement of fact? A husband writes a letter to his wife, quote, 'Dear Senga, I'm sorry I broke your nose last night and beat the kids on the way out. Genghis.' But as Mr Stevenson suggested, no one could seriously argue that that comment should be inadmissible in legal proceedings relating to the matrimonial situation, the care of the children and the protection of that woman from her husband. Issues in relation to the interaction with pre-action protocols and the insurance industry were raised, and I'm pleased we've got to the point where these issues will no longer cause potential difficulties. And it's clear, as the committee recognised, that there are proceedings, such as defamation and fatal accident proceedings, where it would be wholly inappropriate to seek to exclude an apology. Of course, it would also be fair to recognise that there were some, in particular, the Scottish Human Rights Commission, who favoured a broad definition of apology, rather like the original definition in the bill, not the rather more limited version we have in the bill now. But as Bruce Adamson of the Scottish Human Rights Commission said in evidence, quote, "Although we can have discussions about whether to have a limited or more robust definition of apology, what matters in the end is whether the individual victim can have an effective remedy." And he also said, "Apology is very much one tool among many. I agree. But there are issues in relation to sexual abuse where I accept that this bill may not provide all the answers that are being sought. But we should be mindful that the O'Brien inquiry will hopefully provide for at least some answers and public recognition of that abuse, which they have been looking for a very long time. What impact will this bill have? Well, we should just have to wait and see. It seems most unlikely that it will be any form of magic wand. And we know, of course, it was the view of Professor Robin Carroll, an Australian academic, that the little data that exists as to the shift in behaviour from the field of medical practice tells us that such legislation has been relatively ineffective. Nor can it really be said that Scotland has a compensation culture comparable to other jurisdictions. But let's not prejudge the matter. Let's approach the passing of the bill with a positive spirit, wish it well, and thank the member for her passion, for her efforts in steering the bill through its passage, and for dealing with the caution of the Minister. Thank you."
Many thanks, and I now call Margaret McDougall to be followed by Alison McInnes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I too congratulate Margaret Mitchell on bringing this bill forward. When I spoke previously in the Stage 1 debate on the Apology Scotland Bill, I highlighted a number of concerns that I had with the bill. However, during the Stage 2 discussions, the bill was amended. These amendments dealt directly with the concerns I had, so I'm happy to support the bill before us today. The Stage 2 amendments primarily focused on tackling the unintended consequences of the Apologies Bill. In doing so, they have made sure inquiries under the Inquiries Act are no longer covered by the Bill. The reason for this is that inquiries are primarily fact-finding exercises, and it may find that apologies are in the public interest, which is for the inquiry to decide. If they were not exempt, it would bring into question the independence of that inquiry, so this is a welcome improvement. I also welcome that the Children's Hearings Scotland Act 2011 has been exempted from this bill. Concerns were raised that, had the Act been included, cases of child abuse might never see the light of day, or children may not get properly referred, as there wouldn't be enough evidence to establish grounds for this. This amendment was required, in my view. Had it not been accepted, I couldn't have supported the bill. The Stage 2 proceedings also offered much needed clarity on the definition of apology in the bill. Amendments 1 and 10 were in response to the committee evidence that the definition of an apology needs to be reconsidered. This set of amendments removed the references to admissions of fault and statements of fact. Therefore, this helps alleviate concerns that were raised about the access to justice being blocked if these couldn't be used in court to determine liability in action for damages. While my concerns regarding unintended consequences have been tackled, I'm still unsure that the bill will deal with the issue highlighted in the policy memorandum. The policy memorandum states that there appears to be an entrenched culture in Scotland and elsewhere that offering an apology when something has gone wrong is perceived as a weakness. I'm aware of such coincidences and circumstances, but I'm unsure that this piece of legislation will be strong enough to bring about the required cultural change it has been designed to do. That said, the bill is a step in the right direction, and if it does promote a shift in this, it would be welcomed. Obviously, it's difficult to predict what the social effect of the bill will be until we see the consequences of it in practice. In closing, Presiding Officer, I argued during the Stage 1 debate that there needs to be a better balance within the bill to ensure that there are no unintended consequences for victims, while ensuring the bill is still relevant. In my view, the changes that were made at Stage 2 have addressed the concerns I had about the bill. As such, the bill has now struck a much better balance between promoting a cultural shift while also protecting, not excluding, those seeking justice. And I once again congratulate Margaret Mitchell for bringing the bill forward. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call Alison McInnes to be followed by Gil Paterson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Firstly, I too would like to again congratulate Margaret Mitchell on bringing forward this bill. Since Stage 1, the bill has seen some changes which, in my view, improve it. The bill now offers a slightly different definition of apology. The new definition still includes the important aspects of an apology, the expression of regret, and a promise to look into the matter with a view to prevent something similar from happening again. But the removal of admissions of fault and factual statements ensure that we avoid the risk of causing unintended consequences. And of course, as others have said, the bill now also exempts proceedings under the Children's Hearing Scotland Act 2011 from its scope, something that caused me serious concern during Stage 1 proceedings. Because the bill as introduced could have meant that children's panels would not have been able to do their job effectively. That was because currently apologies out with proceedings may sometimes have been used to establish grounds for referral to the hearing system, and this could have had the potential to leave some children and young people behind. So I welcome that change to the bill as it went through the parliamentary process. In relation to protecting children and young people, let me turn to one area that has not been discussed quite as much. During Stage 1 proceedings, the government argued that the bill would add further barriers for the survivors of historic child abuse in gaining justice. And at the same time, the Scottish Human Rights Commission and Margaret Mitchell said that the bill had the potential to actually help survivors. I took the time to contact a number of survivor groups to gain a better understanding of where they stood on the issue. And the response I received was that, in general, survivors are supportive of the bill. One representative stated, "Many survivors of abuse do not wish to pursue legal redress, but closure is important to them to ensure ongoing recovery. Survivors felt let down by those who should have offered them care and were deeply affected by their experiences. An apology does not put right what happened, but it acknowledges the pain and distress caused and gives some comfort that lessons will be learned for the future." So for many of the survivors, the issue is the time bar rather than the ability to use an apology in legal proceedings. And this response above clearly shows an example of where an apology could have had an important role to play in the healing process. And it shows how an apology can enable people to move on with their lives. During Stage 1, I also raised my concerns over the potential clash of this bill with the duty of candour provision included in the Health, Tobacco, Nicotine, etc. and Care Scotland Bill. And I'm pleased that this clash has now been resolved, but I note the recent briefing from the Nursing and Midwifery Council stating that the bill as it stands would still prevent its fitness to practice panels relying on evidence that is currently admitted. I am therefore grateful for the assurances on this from the Minister this afternoon that it is his intention that he will use the powers in the bill to add a further exemption. I think that is welcome clarification. Finally, while I am still not entirely convinced that this bill will create the much-needed cultural change to make apologies more acceptable, which in large was the purpose of the bill, I do hope that it will be a good first step. Cultural and attitudinal shifts take time to happen. So it's important that along with this legislation comes appropriate education, training and guidance that would further encourage this shift. We need organisations to encourage, not discourage, admissions of fault and apologies. We need to work together with the insurance industry to dissuade them from barring their customers from making apologies for fear of having their policies invalidated. The Scottish Liberal Democrats intend to support the bill at decision time. Let me close by commending the member in charge, Margaret Mitchell, for her determination to pursue this, but also for her willingness to negotiate with the government to ensure that the bill could progress to this stage. I thank her for doing that, and I do hope that it brings about the cultural change that she hopes for.
Many thanks, and I now call Gil Paterson.
Presiding Officer, can I thank, first of all, Margaret Mitchell for her determination and the way that she chaperoned her bill through the Parliament. She's been a very good listener. She's made the changes, and that's, all these things are to her credit. Presiding Officer, the aim of the bill is to provide that an expression of apology is admissible as evidence for the purposes of civil legal proceedings, excluding defamation proceedings and fatal accident inquiries. The bill as drafted makes provisions for expression of sympathy or regret, any statements of fact and any admission of fault or undertakings does not amount to an admission of liability. Apologies have the great value of acknowledging that something has gone wrong and demonstrating that lessons have been learnt. Presiding Officer, in everyday life, in the not-too-distant past, it was commonly the purpose of people to make a full apology. It was considered as basic good manners, and it happened everywhere. It happened in the workplace, it happened at play, whether it was in school, playground, or in an older time in your life. It happened in the home. It's a frequent thing. Even in those days, though, that fallouts could happen, just for simple, straightforward reason that an apology wasn't made. Or, you know, it was maybe big-headedness in the part of people. You could lose your friends for life, and there could be even feuds. And just because somebody didn't say sorry. But matters in the past, having said that, were much easier. I fear for the Americanisation of our cultural now, our culture, and it's changed matters for the worse. We've got almost an industry of ambulance chasing and no wins, no fees. And then you have things that have happened in general with companies and officialdom. They're less likely to say sorry. They worry about claims, and we need to go back to where we were. And this bill, I think, will help that. It could be a more polite and non-confrontational society because of this bill. I know it wouldn't be easy, because I do think it's a cultural change that we're looking for. Margaret's to be congratulated in listening to the witnesses, but I did forget to mention that the government, I think the government have also played their part to make these changes happen. And I think it gets the balance right. And it will help the social change and the attitudes that we're clearly seeking. The bill will surely help that happen, in my view. Scotland isn't the first jurisdiction to have legislation in this regard in force. It's in force in the USA, in Canada and Australia. Although they're not identical, but they all seek the same outcome. An apology doesn't mean that litigation does not happen, but saying sorry does not mean that it will, and that's what everyone's trying to achieve. A simple apology under this legislation just means that a simple sorry in itself is without fear of an admission or guilt. It gives space for a sorry to take place without the fear of litigation. Many people in everyday life, a simple apology for most things still happens. But even in very serious circumstances, for instance, in historic child abuse, then victims crave that an apology happens. Now, that's not in any way to say that victims of historic abuse, sexual or otherwise, would not want their case to be pursued in the courts. But an apology for many people is an enormous step for them in moving forward in their lives and possibly moving forward for the very first time. So the simple apology in itself can make a difference. In general terms, as explained, attitudes have hardened. To find a way to overcome that with a simple apology is something that we can maybe help society to change. And I want to say that Margaret's bill can change things for the better. And, you know, I'm very grateful that she's been diligent in what she's tried to achieve. Thanks for doing that, Margaret.
Thank you very much. I now call in Gavin Brown, up to 5 minutes, please.
Presiding officer, thank you. It's been, I think, a very short but useful debate where we've had everything from references to Charles I to the idea that still amuses me slightly of Margaret Mitchell saying back in 2012 this should be pretty straightforward. Presiding officer, it has, I think, for me, being an example of how legislation ought to work. The original bill is drafted pretty well and the broad principles are in the right ballpark. Over the course of committee discussions and debates, the risks are removed one by one and other sections are strengthened so that we end up at stage three with a good bill with which it's difficult to disagree. And I think it is one of the first debates I've been in 9 years in this Parliament where there's not been a single intervention on any of the speakers outside of members' business, perhaps. Some useful contributions, I think, during the course of the debate. I was very interested to hear Alison MacInnes's point that she has personally contacted groups and individuals representing survivors of historic abuse, and it was comforting to hear that they still are strongly in favour of the bill. That ties in exactly with comments that Margaret Mitchell had made to me over the last couple of weeks as well. And that's vital, just given the genesis of how this bill came about, where it came from. It was absolutely vital that those groups were still 100% behind it. And I think, again, I'm very comforted to hear indeed that that is the case. Enjoyed Gil Patterson's contribution, as I always do, who just commented, I think, briefly that back in the day, apologies for whatever reason just tended to happen much more regularly than they do today. And I think he hopes, like many of us, that this bill will be a vital first step in ensuring that we go back to where we were before there. Presiding officer, it has been touched on by a number of members, and no doubt the government will touch on it too in closing, but this is just the first step, and the training, as we know, will be required to make sure that those on the front line are able to get things right. In particular, they'll need to, I think, be given careful training on exactly what is included in the scope of the bill, exactly what is excluded on the scope of the bill, given that we do have a number of exceptions down there now, just so that those people can be absolutely crystal clear on what they're able to do and not do. We've heard that guidance will be required, and I'm sure the case will be that the government will want to involve people like Margaret Mitchell and those on the Justice Committee in making sure that the guidance is as good as it can be, so that, again, it has the ultimate impact that we all want it to have. Ultimately, the legislative change will only be of great value if it leads to cultural change, and that is the big question. That is what we all want to see. We want to end this perception that you can't say sorry. We want to end the perception that it is somehow seen as a sign of weakness, and we want to try and calm the fears of litigation, because Rod Campbell is right, we're not as prolific in terms of litigation as some other jurisdictions, but there could be no doubt from listening to some of the witnesses that is a genuine fear held by some, and that is a genuine reason given by many for not actually giving an apology. So, Presiding Officer, we don't know for sure exactly what impact it will have, but I was particularly taken by a clause in the committee report that said legislation is not the magic formula, but it has a role to play even if it does not have a dramatic effect. So as long as it has some form of effect, I think it has a role to play. But given the guidance and training we all want to see and push for, I'm pretty hopeful that it can have a more than at least a minor effect. Alison McInnes, I think, put it pretty well, and she did say, again, she wasn't sure exactly what effect it would have going forward, but she described this as a vital first step, and she's absolutely right. This is a vital first step that we all hope will have the impact that we desire. But what we can say for certain is that if we didn't take this vital first step, then we could almost guarantee the fact that we wouldn't see the cultural change that we all want to see. So it is a first step. I'm very hopeful that it will have the impact that we want to see, and I look forward to voting in favour of it at decision time today. Thank you.
Many thanks. And I now call on Graham Pearson. Up to 5 minutes, please, Mr Pearson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Many members around the Chamber quite properly acknowledged Margaret Mitchell's hard work and her persistence in following through the introduction of this bill and shepherding it through committee and its negotiations with the government. I think, too, it was touched on that her compromise at key moments were common sense responses and not in any way a betrayal of her original intentions in providing the bill, and that we have come to a position where we should also acknowledge Paul Wheelhouse's sensible responses on behalf of the government in bringing us to where we are today, the birth of a new piece of legislation subject to the vote at the end of this debate. Members also acknowledged that Justice Committee and the civil servants who service that committee have provided a great deal of background work in taking us to a position where, although not perfect and reflected by a number of members that this is a first stage, declares an intention on behalf of Parliament that there should be a different culture, a different approach as we go forward. And it is right that the Human Rights Commission, in supporting the approach that Margaret Mitchell developed within her own working cross-party working group, helped in providing the kernel that now forms part of not only the policy memorandum, but hopefully the act that we come to visit at the end. The policy memorandum indicates that obstacles do exist to apologising in Scotland. It did argue, and I quote, an entrenched culture in Scotland and elsewhere that offering an apology when something has gone wrong is perceived as a sign of weakness. And it also said a fear that an acknowledgement of fault can lead to litigation. I would add a third subsection, that there's also an individual fear in a professional sense that offering an apology offers a threat to future opportunities for advancement in career terms. And that in some way sometimes silences people in saying the right thing at the right time. Members, Margaret McDougall, Gavin Brown and others indicated that there wasn't a compensation culture in Scotland. But as an example, compensation payments made by the NHS in Scotland through clinical negligence and other risk indemnity schemes, payments have risen from 1.6 million in the year 2000 to 2001 to 58.24 million in 2010 and 11. And I don't think that I will be alone in this chamber in having dealt with constituents who began a journey of complaint merely wanting an apology, an explanation, and a confidence that circumstances would not be repeated. And that not only pertains to health service complaints, but a whole range of complaints that we receive across the board. The policy memorandum argued that in many cases, people only are complaining about a particular situation simply to achieve an apology, a sincere apology, and an assurance that the situation will improve for the future. So to that extent, I think that change in culture that's flagged up by this proposed Act is to be welcomed. It's an open door to those who act on our behalf in public services to take the opportunity to offer an apology in the right circumstances, to leave a complainer in no doubt at an early stage that what they've said has been heard, has been understood, is believed, the evidence supports the fact that an apology is due, and that it is offered sincerely with a view to repairing the situation for the future. And in all those circumstances, I think that the bill proposed by Margaret Mitchell and now agreed between her and the government goes a long way towards providing the kinds of circumstances that make life better for the general public in the future. The bill applies to all civil proceedings apart from the ones that many of the members have mentioned in the chamber today and is not retrospective in effect. Members have expressed a view that they're unsure if it achieves what it set out to achieve in the first instance. But I think that without a step into the unknown in the way that we will do this afternoon, no change in culture can be achieved.
You must close, please.
And in that regard, I do welcome the bill, and we will be supporting the government when it comes to the vote. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call on Paul Wheelhouse. Around 6 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I would genuinely like to thank all members for their contributions to this debate. I'm sure Margaret Mitchell will do so herself, for their interest in the promotion of a culture change in the giving of apologies. And it is clear that the bill touches upon an issue that is very close to the hearts of many people. And I certainly agree with Graham Pearson and others who say we've all met individuals who started a journey. They probably only wanted an apology and a recognition that they were right in their concern about what had happened and to be able to move on. And it sometimes snowballs from there into something that's more significant. I'm very grateful, I think, for the widespread support that Margaret Mitchell has had for her bill today, because I think it has made the process easier for both the government and indeed for the member to have such broad support. But I've been struck, as I was at stage one, by the member's recognition of the importance of this legislation and the origins of that, and I think it's a particularly poignant one for the member to be able to secure this today. But I'd like to thank members again for their engagement with the bill throughout the parliamentary process and engagement with my team indeed. Gavin Brown, I would like to thank for his very kind remarks as well, and I think he also pointed out very appropriately that this is a very good testament to the procedures of the Parliament, how it's worked from stage one, a very constructive debate, stage two working again constructively across all sides, and indeed on to stage three, where I believe we have achieved a bill which has addressed the primary concerns that Margaret Mitchell set out from the start, but hopefully one that has comforted individuals, not least the government, but individuals across the chamber about any concerns that arose. I'd like to reiterate my thanks again to the convener, Christine Graham, of the committee, and all the members of the Justice Committee for their detailed and careful consideration of the bill and for helping to shape the bill we have today. And my thanks to individuals and organisations again who engaged with the bill process. I would like to spend a bit of time just talking about some of the other points I raised in answer to Elaine Murray's point, and I thank her for not making an issue of it at the amendments. My understanding of transitory procedures are where there's perhaps a fixed date, but it's very similar in nature to transitional procedures, but it's perhaps to cover the gap between the new legislation coming into force and old provisions being dropped by Parliament, and there's usually a fixed date associated with it. But I'm happy to get chapter and verse to Elaine Murray in due course. A number of members, I was struck by what Gil Paterson said, as Gavin Brown referred to, the fact that we have, unfortunately, it's a regret actually that society has changed to that degree, where perhaps it's a matter of good manners. People did give apologies in the past, but I hope that Margaret Mitchell's bill will move us a little way down to that end, that we will have a return to good manners and the giving of apologies where they are warranted. Margaret McDougall, I think, very helpfully for her own interest, but also, for Parliament as well, set out how procedures work, how stage two concerns were addressed. And I think that's very helpful for us parliamentarians to explain to the public how the procedures work. And I think she set out very eloquently how her own concerns about Children's Hearing Scotland Act and other areas had been addressed in passage. So I think that, again, proves the merits of the process. Rod Campbell made a specific point in reference to the insurance industry, and it would be important just to point out the bill does make provisions for the effect of an apology in certain legal proceedings. It does not change the law, of course, in relation to the insurance industry, which is reserved. And there is no requirement for an individual to make an apology. But by voting for the Apology Scotland Bill today at Stage 3, the Parliament will send an important message, I think, about the value of apologies and the need to encourage a culture where apologies are more freely offered. And I hope the insurance industry will take note of that message. However, individuals may wish to consider the terms insurance contracts of their insurance contracts in this regard in future as well. And it's important to make that point. In relation to the debate we've had today, I think a number of members have referred particularly to survivors of historic child abuse and who have taken the time to consider the bill and share their thoughts. I just want to reiterate my thanks to those who have engaged with me personally, but those who have also engaged with other members throughout. Alison McInnes referred to them, and I think it would be wrong of us not to have acknowledged today the origins of the legislation indeed coming forward, but also the particular group that may be impacted positively by it. I think also in relation to points that Alison McInnes made and indeed others about education, training and guidance, I fully accept we need to try and support the process as best we can to educate those in public services particularly, but wider society as to the benefits of the legislation and the advantages there may be to them. I know many individuals who work in public sector who have said to me they wish they could have given an apology, but they were fearful of litigation. And that's not to excuse that, but I think we can all understand the pressures on them. And I hope that, as Graham Pearson alluded, this will be a significant step forward in that respect. I'd like to thank also the Non-Government Bills Unit here in the Scottish Parliament, Presiding Officer. I know they have been working closely with Margaret Mitchell, as well as with Scottish Government officials throughout this process, and they have supported our own constructive discussions. And I outlined earlier, my main concern with the original wording of the bill was the potential unintended consequences of restricting access to justice for pursuers wanting to make a fair claim. And based on discussions that we had involving the Non-Government Bills Unit and Margaret Mitchell and further engagement with stakeholders, not least Professor Alan Miller, we concluded it was possible to find a suitable compromise which would keep the essence of the bill but minimise the unintended consequences. And I believe we have achieved that today if we support this today at decision time. In conclusion, I'd like to reiterate my thanks to Margaret Mitchell for proposing this bill. I am grateful for the work she has done and for working with the government, and I hope that the outcome of the bill, as I said earlier on, this bill process is one that sends an important message about the values of apologies, which has the potential to change attitude in Scotland, and I'm pleased we are at this point today to support the bill. Thank you.
Many thanks, Minister. I now call on Margaret Mitchell to wind up the debate. 8 minutes, please, Ms Mitchell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In closing the debate this evening, I wish to take this opportunity to thank some of the individuals without whom the bill would not have reached this stage. I start with Mary Dinsdale, Andrew Milne and Neil Ross from the Non-Government Bills Unit, NGBU for short, who have been a tremendous support and source of wise advice throughout this process. Their hard work, research and counsel have been invaluable, as has their encouragement when even introducing this bill was less than straightforward. There was a good deal of research carried out initially before the proposition for the bill was even mooted with the NGBU, and then as the bill progressed. And here I thank Kate Wayne and Greg Lamont for the huge amount of work they carried out to get the bill off the ground and presenting a case for its introduction. Before the actual draft bill was produced, further research was required, and here Douglas Maxwell's research and involvement was a tremendous help. And I want to give particular thanks to my parliamentary researcher, Felicity Hollins, for her continuous support and advice, and I also thank Maureen Morrison, who helped smooth the bill through its passage prior to stage two. It would be remiss of me not to acknowledge the Law Society of Scotland's Michael Clancy's sound guidance on the Bill's competence, when with analytical precision he established the Bill was competent as it merely clarified the law of evidence in civil proceedings. I owe a huge debt of gratitude to Professor Prue Vines, who is based in the Faculty of Law at the University of New South Wales, and as well as being a visiting professor at the University of Strathclyde, she is the recognised academic expert on apologies legislation. Her world-renowned research into apologies and into the effect of New South Wales apologies legislation significantly informed the bill as introduced. She has given me excellent advice based on her research on what constitutes an effective apology. In addition to this, she has responded immediately when the bill appeared to be floundering by helping to tease out the problem and give her comments about the proposed way forward. I know she will derive a huge amount of pleasure if Parliament passes the bill tonight. John Sturrock QC has also provided much appreciated support and suggestions throughout the bill's introduction and passage. I particularly want to thank him for organising an event in the Parliament with Ken Cloak, mediator and internationally acclaimed writer on conflict resolution. Ken's powerful testimonies highlighting the effectiveness of an apology within his own work as a mediator helped remind me and confirm how important it was to press ahead with this legislation, securing the knowledge that aiding a culture of apologising to flourish in Scotland benefits both those harmed and those responsible for the harm caused. I've already referred to the role played by Professor Alan Miller, Chair of the Scottish Human Rights Commission, in making me aware of apologies legislation in the first place when he visited the cross-party group on adult survivors of childhood sexual abuse. His conviction and that of Prue Vines that a protected apology is essential for apologies legislation to be truly effective has been crucial to my understanding that the apology has to be inadmissible in civil proceedings. So when the suggestion at stage one that the bill should follow the wording of the Compensation Act 2006, which allows an apology to be admissible, was mooted, Professor Miller succinctly explained the adverse consequences which would follow when he said, adopting a similar model to that of the Compensation Act 2006 would not achieve the aims of the bill and would not meet the expectations of the survivors of historic childhood abuse in Scotland. His views and the experience of the cross-party group and adult survivors of childhood sexual abuse proved to be pivotal in helping to ensure the inadmissibility provision remained. And I pay tribute to the members of the cross-party group for their contributions and consistent and continued support during the scrutiny process. Here it's worth reiterating the representative views from one of the survivor organisation members of the CPG, who confirmed that for so many survivors, it's not legal actions or compensation which is important, but rather what they want above all else is closure to move on with their lives. And this helps the healing process. And the acknowledgement of what happened also gives them hope that perhaps they can prevent the same fate befalling someone else. Presiding Officer, the first recognised apologies legislation was enacted in the US state of Massachusetts in 1986 after a young girl named Claire Saltonstall was hit and killed by a car while riding her bicycle near her family home. And the driver who struck her never did apologise. Her father, William L. Saltonstall, a state senator, was angry that the driver had not expressed contrition. He was told the driver dared not risk apologising because it could have constituted an admission in litigation surrounding the girl's death. Upon his retirement, the senator and his successor presented the legislature with a bill designed to create a safe harbour for would-be apologisers. As previously stated at stage one, this was the first tentative step, which has since resulted in over 35 US states and many nations around the world, including Australia, Canada and New Zealand, introducing apologies legislation. In the consultation which went out prior to my bill being introduced, I cited a scenario which every member in this chamber will recognise. Namely, a constituent comes to them and outlines an adverse experience, whether involving a local authority, the police, or a utility or retail company, or a quango, and then goes on to say they don't want to take legal action, but they do want an acknowledgement of the adverse experience and an apology, and above all, to ensure that it doesn't happen to anyone else. Equally, we all know that fear of litigation more often than not prevents them receiving that apology. So I'm hugely gratified. Whilst the duty of candour will apply to the Health Service, the Apologies Scotland Bill addresses and resolves the fear of litigation problem elsewhere in both the public and private sector, and has also positive and significant early resolution and preventative spend implications and savings. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I am also immensely proud, if the bill is passed this evening, that Scotland will be leading the way within the UK on apologies legislation.
Many thanks. And that concludes the debate on the Apologies Scotland Bill, and it's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 15343 in the name of Michael McMahon on a review of the public petitions process. I'd invite members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, please. And I would like to call on Michael McMahon to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the Public Petitions Committee. Mr McMahon, if you're ready, 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to open this debate on the review of the petitions process. This is the fourth debate we've had on the Parliament's petitions process since 1999, and the second such debate in which I've spoken as convener of the committee. The petitions process has, of course, developed since 1999, and a number of changes have been made over that time. What remains constant, though, is the importance of the petitions process in enabling people to get issues of concern to them onto the agenda of the Parliament. I have a few words of thanks before I go on to talk about the most recent findings about that process. The research that we are discussing today was commissioned prior to me becoming convener. John Penton was the convener at the time, and it's right to recognise his contribution. Indeed, it's right to recognise all members who have served on the Petitions Committee in the course of the session, and also its other convener, David Stewart. The research was carried out for the committee by Gareth James, and I'm pleased that Gareth is attending the debate today so that I can extend thanks to him on behalf of the committee. His work has provided the committee with evidence and an analysis that increases our knowledge and deepens our understanding of how the process is seen. Finally, and most importantly, I offer the committee's thanks to the petitioners who have contributed to the research, either through responding to a survey or in more detailed interviews. Their willingness to share their experiences is invaluable in allowing the committee to understand the perceptions and expectations that people have of the Parliament's petitions process. Turning now to the research and what it tells us about that process, the purpose of the research was fourfold and was intended to monitor progress against the last review in 2009, benchmark our process against processes in other legislatures, capture some socio-economic data about petitioners, and ask petitioners about their expectations and experiences. The research found that the recommendations of the 2009 review have, to some extent, been taken forward. What is interesting to see is how the development of digital technologies has possibly overtaken some of those recommendations. For example, the system of supporting petitions via SMS messaging was implemented but has not been used. That will be worth bearing in mind for future developments of the system. In terms of benchmarking our process, there are a number of similarities in the processes in place in other legislatures. The Scottish process seems to have fewest restrictions in relation to signatures and support, given that a petition requires only one signature and does not need the support of an elected member. In other ways, it might be said that our process places more of an expectation on petitioners. For example, they are required to tell us what they have previously done to try and resolve the issue of concern to them. The Scottish process also differs in comparison to legislatures where petitions processes include an element of an ombudsman function. The socio-economic data captured in the research appears to tell us two things. The demographic profile of petitioners does not appear to have changed from the profile that was found in work carried out 10 years ago, and that the profile of petitioners does not reflect the diversity of the general population of Scotland. Put simply, the socio-demographic profile skews towards older white men who are relatively affluent and who have been educated to degree level. So having been told these things by the research, the committee's report sets out its initial responses. It does so under two broad headings, engagement and transparency. The committee's final responses and recommendations will be set out in our legacy paper. These recommendations will be informed by this debate and by a workshop that we will hold next month. On engagement, the committee considers that undertaking engagement events on a more frequent basis should be a target for the next session. These events should be a combination of formal committee meetings and more informal workshops or visits. The amount of engagement is, however, only one consideration. Of at least equal importance is the quality of engagement. Attendance at the committee's external meeting in Inverary last September commented that they would have welcomed the opportunity to contribute to and participate in that meeting. And the committee recognises that active participation is a key part of engagement, and opportunities for this must therefore be considered in the design of future engagement events. The transparency of the petitions process is an area where the committee recognises improvements can be made. As members will be aware, there have been criticisms made about the number of petition proposals that were received that did not go on to be lodged as petitions. I am pleased that more detailed analysis of the numbers has been included in the research. This analysis shows the reasons for proposed petitions not going on to be lodged, and that when broken down, the figures for Scotland are broadly comparable with those for other jurisdictions. However, this type of information, which clearly helps in understanding the process, has not routinely been available. The committee has agreed, therefore, that a system should be established to record and publish information about proposed petitions that are not eventually lodged. Now, I've already commented on the findings about the demographic profile of petitioners. This type of information is valuable to assist us to know who petitioners are and which groups or communities are underrepresented. However, demographic data is not routinely captured at the moment. We have set out our intention to suggest in our legacy paper ways in which this information could be captured, and we welcome any thoughts members may have on this. The final area I will mention is the consideration that the committee gives to petitions and how clearly our decisions are understood. This is the area of the petitions process that respondents to the survey were least satisfied with. We place a great deal of importance on hearing the views of petitioners throughout our consideration of petitions. And whenever we receive submissions on a petition, the petitioner will be given the opportunity to submit their views and to request further actions that the committee could take. This happens before the committee looks at those submissions. In addition, the committee will also consider requests from petitioners to give additional oral evidence. However, the opportunity to give additional evidence will always need to be balanced against the opportunity for the committee to hear from petitioners on the first occasion that a petition is considered. Now, what the research tells us is that we need to reflect on how we can communicate our decisions more effectively. For trust to be maintained, it is vital that petitioners and others with an interest in the petition system can understand how decisions are reached. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I look forward to hearing the contribution from other members today. The research concludes that petitioners are able to feel more engaged in politics as a result of the petitions process. However, there are areas where we can and should improve to deliver a world-leading system. Any ideas that are put forward in this debate will be considered for inclusion in the committee's legacy paper. We hope this will form the basis of further development of the process into the next session and beyond. And so I conclude by moving S4M 15343 on behalf of the Public Petitions Committee. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call on Joe Fitzpatrick, Minister. You have 2 minutes, so thereby, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is right and proper that the Parliament regularly reviews its procedures. That allows the Parliament to examine what has worked well and what it can do better, with the aim of making this Parliament the best it can be for the people of Scotland. One of the measures of the Parliament's success is how open and accessible it is to the people it represents. A key element of that is ensuring the petition system is effective. The petition system permits people from all strands of civic society to put issues of importance to them on the parliamentary agenda and to ask responsible bodies, including the government of the day, to act on those. Before we look at how the system might improve, I think we should take a note of some of the successful petitions that have secured change. In 2000, a petition called for the reinstatement of railway services to the Scottish borders. It attracted over 17,000 signatures and provided a significant step in the introduction of the Waverley Railway Scotland Bill to rebuild a section of the line. This culminated in the longest section of new railway to be built in the UK for about 100 years, and which has proved highly popular since it opened last September. And in 2014, a petition was lodged to have the Tinker's Heart of Argyll recognised, restored and listed as a monument of national historic significance. This is the only monument that the Scottish travelling community has. The site did not initially meet the criteria set out by Historic Scotland, but the petition impressed Historic Scotland to such an extent that it led to a fresh evaluation of the circumstances and a public consultation. This site was reassessed and is now recognised as a site of high cultural significance to travellers and to the whole of Scotland. This Parliament should be seeking to build on those successes, and I look forward to hearing members' thoughts and suggestions during today's debate. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call on David Stewart. Mr Stewart, you have 5 minutes or thereby.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'm very pleased to be able to speak today as one of the ex-conveners of the Public Petitions Committee, and a very happy 4 years I spent there, and I see some familiar faces in the Chamber today who were members when I was convener. Members may know that we've had a long tradition of petitions in Scotland. In fact, if members require a little history lesson, if you look at the early mists of time, David II in the 14th century actually invented the first petitions system, arguably in the world, when he gave a right for every subject to petition the king. So obviously 700 years later, and the advent of the Scottish Parliament provided an ideal opportunity to resurrect this tradition. But, Presiding Officer, we shouldn't forget as well that the previous Scottish Parliament, finishing in 1707, also had a petitions system. And I asked Spice to give some information to me about that system and found that there was a very interesting test case in 1605, I think it was, when a Church of Scotland minister in St Andrews wished to move his charge from St Andrews to Edinburgh, petitioned the Scottish Parliament and was awarded a change of charge at £5 a year. So it shows I can predate the business manager's examples of best practice. And as we all know, of course, the Parliament was founded on four guiding principles which underpin all the areas of Parliament's work, not, of course, just the Petitions Committee, but I think that they're very relevant to readdress these. Obviously, power sharing, sometimes we forget about that, between the Parliament and the Scottish Government and the people of Scotland. Accessibility, openness and participation, accountability and equal opportunities. I would also like to give some examples, and they all happen to come from my time as convener, but I would stress that I'm not trying to get any particular credit for that. But there was four petitions that really jumped out to me about how you can actually make a difference when sometimes, irrespective of who's in power, you do require to give the minister a chase. You need to bang some department chiefs' heads together to get some common sense. And I think a petitions committee can do that. Let me give you a couple of examples. I know Jackson Carlow was there at the time. The one that really struck me was about pain relief, when we had a whole pile of constituents and petitioners who had chronic problems with pain relief. And at the time, the only pain relief centre in the UK was in Bath. And Alec Neil, I think, was the Cabinet Secretary at the time. And following representations on that petition, he agreed that there would be pain relief centres throughout health boards in Scotland. I think that was a great success. The one that also struck me was about mesh devices, and we had whole series of women that turned up in wheelchairs. And I can say in my 9 years now in the Parliament and previous period in other Parliament, that was probably the most emotionally charged day I've ever had, when women said firsthand about the absolute dreadful experience that they experienced with these mesh devices. And we had the Deputy Chief Medical Officer there, who said that, yes, of course, women can now take legal action if there have been faults in the mesh devices and the health problems that that's caused. But at the time, you actually needed to know the reference number of the mesh device. I mean, how bureaucratic can you possibly get? But I'm glad to see, following great work, I think, also by the Sunday Mail, who did a tremendous campaign on this, that that has achieved a huge success. The one that myself and Chick Brody, I don't think Chick Brody is here today, was particularly interested in was a register of interests of the judiciary. And members will recall we had a real fight about whether we could cite the Lord President before the committee. And again, Chick Brody, the Deputy Convener, I managed, with the committee support, to meet the Lord President, or the ex-Lord President now, and achieve, I think, a breakthrough, perhaps not fully to the mind of the constituents and to the petitioners, but now it's possible to get a register of those sheriffs and judges who have excused themselves in a court procedure, which didn't happen before. And the final one, Presiding Officer, I know I don't have much time left, is about democratic and employment rights for young footballers. As a football fan myself, and I declare my interest in Inverness Cali Thistle, and they need all the support they can get this week, particularly when they're playing tonight in the Scottish Cup, I was appalled to find the terrible employment conditions that young footballers were having to sign up to. And we had the whole of the football hierarchy in front of us. And I do believe that achieved some change as well. So these examples make a difference. In the few seconds left, Presiding Officer, what I would say is, I think the review was excellent, and I would agree with every word that my colleague Michael McMahon has said. When I was speaking as convener in various exotic climes like Johannesburg and Belgrade and the Welsh Parliament and in Westminster, I often said I was an evangelist for the committee. I'd like to think I'm still an evangelist for the Petitions Committee, but I think where we've got to move is we're excellent at representing accountants in Bear's Den. We're perhaps not quite as good at representing artisans in Easterhouse. We need to get out and about more, go around disadvantaged estates, but it's a tremendous committee. I think it takes pride and all the work it's done for this Parliament, and on that point I conclude. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thanks very much. I now call on Jackson Carlow. 5 minutes, Mr Carlow, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very happy to contribute to this debate this afternoon. I do so as an unreserved fan of the parliamentary petitions process in this Scottish Parliament. And I say that as someone who, towards the end of my first Parliament in 2011, produced my own report as to why I thought, in many other respects, the procedures of this Parliament are unnecessarily straitjacketing on the spontaneity which there might otherwise be. The hideous process by which we have to submit parliamentary questions well in advance to notify ministers of our intent, very often meaning that they no longer have any topicality by the time we ask them. The sort of dismal, sort of pedestrian nature of many of our debates, in which contributions are weighted by parliamentary representation rather than any interest or knowledge of the subject about which we might be having a conversation. But I exempt from that the parliamentary petitions process, where, having gone on to it, actually more or less by accident, my colleague Nanette Milne had sat on it, and I was on the Health Committee, and it was felt that there was a bill that was going forward that Nanette would be leading on. I offered to swap, and I found when I got to parliamentary petitions I had no wish to leave, because on this committee members come free of any party whip, usually with a completely objective and open mind as to the subjects that are going to be discussed. And I think, with great credit, members have pursued, and this is the critical thing, not just how do petitions come to the committee, but what does the committee do with the petitions that come to it? And what has impressed me is that, without fear or favour, members of the Petitions Committee, and that they have changed in the time I've been there, have been prepared to pursue the issue at heart without fear or favour, and ministers coming to a committee to give evidence know that they can't just smile at friends and hope that all will be well. They have to come and answer the detail of the petition in hand. And I think that... Yes, Mr. Don.
I'm very grateful to Jackson Carlow for doing so. I just can't help reflecting that all I've heard so far, I think, is suggesting that in this session that has been the case. Can I just confirm that in the previous session, when I too sat on that committee, exactly the same prevailed, and I think that actually makes Mr. Carlow's point.
Happy to agree with the golden age of Nigel Dawn on petitions, equally as much as I am with the golden age of petitions with David Stewart. So, I accept that that's the point I'm making. I think that it is a committee that has always been prepared to do that. And therefore, it is an extremely interesting and rewarding committee on which to sit. And before my time, there was a petition raised by Mike and Tina Gray about access to new medicines, which I think led to a completely transformational way in which end-of-life medicines were made available to the wider Scottish public. And as Mr. Stewart mentioned, in this Parliament, I think one of the most extraordinary petitions that we have heard has been the one on vaginal mesh implants, which, of course, has had ramifications as a result of the interrogation of that issue here in Scotland across the whole world, where Scotland was the first to act at a government level with dramatic intent and actually to bring about potentially a change in the well-being of the lives of those affected. Now, it's not that I'm indifferent to our need to broaden access. Actually, what matters to me more is the substance of the petition that comes before us, and I would like to see that enhanced. But in terms of access, the particular contribution I make to the recommendations that are in this draft, this early report, before we consider the evidence of the debate elsewhere, is that it is now the custom and practice of all members to issue annual parliamentary reports. And it seems to me that if we are going to harness the capability of the Parliament to promote the petitions process to the widest possible body of people, what would be useful would be within those parliamentary reports for there to be an advertisement from the Parliament about the parliamentary petitions process and almost an encouragement by the member issuing the leaflet to offer to help facilitate the petitions that some of their constituents might be interested in raising. Because I think that that then would allow the petitions process to be advertised to this widest possible community and for those who might feel slightly intimidated about the potential process to feel that they had a link beyond the very helpful clerks to seeing that that petition is implemented. I think it is our extraordinary committee. I think it stands head and shoulders above many parliamentary petitions committees the world over. One signature on one petition can ensure that an important issue is heard in this Parliament and action can follow. I think we should be very proud of that.
Many thanks. We now move to open debate on this subject, and I call on Kenny McCaskill to be followed by Hanzala Malik. Mr. McCaskill, you have 4 minutes. So
thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I heartily endorse the comments made initially by the current serving convener, and I think endorsed throughout the chamber by every speaker that has spoken so far. To some extent, the chamber simply echoing the committee, where we do tend to operate by consensus, and that is a good thing. I have to say, I wasn't aware of the precise history, and I'm grateful for David Stewart for his input on that. But I do always remember when I first came into this Parliament in 1999 that the Consultative Steering Group was taking pride in new aspects being brought to the openness that was going to be created here. And part of that was to be both the Petitions Committee and how it would operate and how we would interact, not just through that, but in our daily lives with the people that we are privileged to represent. It has always been something I think the Parliament has rightly taken pride in, and I think Jackson Carlow is right to make those points. Others have learnt from us, even here in the City of Edinburgh. The Council have now mirrored it, slightly different, but again, I think building upon what was here. There's obviously been aspects that the committee has learnt from elsewhere, and conveners have travelled far and wide to make sure that not only do we impart what we believe that we can contribute, but learn from others. And as I say, that's a good thing. Until late 2014, I hadn't experienced it other than being, as I say, occasionally contributing to points on behalf of constituents and supporting them in petitions that they'd been making, but also just in picking up the vibes from all those who operated there, either as parliamentarians or as members of the public. I had always had a memory that it reminded me of my days as a lawyer, a judicial review as an outlet where no other aspect was available. And I think to some extent the Petitions Committee is about that. It's not about overt political power. It's not necessarily about moving a direct motion. It is about allowing people to have their say, to have their voice, as individuals have said, sometimes on deeply serious, quite moving issues that are indeed quite stressful for the committee, and the strain is written and etched upon the faces of those contributing, but also sometimes perhaps more flippant or lightheartedly, but they are entitled to be put because the individuals do feel quite passionate about that. There are obviously points that have to be learned. There's aspects that will be passed to the legacy paper to the committee, but there's some points I think that remain universal. The point has already been made about the benefit of external visits. I've participated in them. They were enjoyable. How we can maximise the benefit for the communities that we're going is something that we have to think about. I do believe that they've worked well. That doesn't mean, though, that they can't work better. But again, we have to get the balance right between going around the country, but also ensuring that we're here for those who wish to petition, and there's a significant volume of them. We also, and I think as a committee, recently we've been challenged not simply by the right of people to lodge their petition, but we do have to take on board the rights and feelings of others who can be perhaps affected. And therefore, these things can be challenging because we've had to consider and work through as a committee how we don't seem to prejudge any aspect, but do take on board that there could be interference in the lives and effects upon others. Equally, we have to get the balance right between inquiries that have been mentioned that have been remarkably successful and indeed were definitely necessary, but also ensuring that we can just allow people their evidence and their say, either just by lodging the petition and doing what they wish thereafter, or indeed coming and having their voice heard. So I do believe that it's about building upon what was established here in 1999. It has been a pleasure to serve upon the committee, and I do think that consensus rightly continues. There's things that can be learnt, but equally, there's an awful lot that we just have to maintain.
Many thanks. And I now call on Hans Ala Mallet to be followed by Angus MacDonald.
Thank you very much and good afternoon, Presiding Officer. It's a pleasure to speak on the review of public petitions process in the Scottish Parliament today, and the public petition system and the committee that serves a very important element in terms of engaging with the people to try and shape what the Scottish Parliament does for its people that we serve. And in general, the system is viewed as very positive. But, Presiding Officer, I want to share some of the feelings that I have gathered during my period on the committee. I have seen farmers coming to the Petitions Committee claiming that their human rights have been violated. And I actually agreed with them. I agreed with them in the system that we knew that there was a case to be answered. We also knew that they couldn't afford the legal system to pay for the cause that they wished to bring to book, yet the government let them down. And for the first time ever, I felt that as a nation, we had actually let our own people down. But it was a good democratic way of actually reaching that consensus. And I think it was important that I at least shared my feelings with the petitioners. And I think that was an important element to do so, because I wanted people to feel that we do care. Also, there are many other ways in which we have engaged with people through the process at the committee. Single parents' rights, for example, was another one that touched my heart in the sense of how people face huge challenges and difficulties where parents can be so difficult with each other, they sometimes forget how their children are being affected by the relationship, breakdown relationships. And also, I think, sometimes how children lose out because the parents are too busy fighting each other. That is currently still going through the process, and I hope that we'll be able to do justice to both sets of parents, because end of the day, we want to ensure that the children no longer suffer. And these are the type of things that normally don't go through the court system or our system, and the petitions. Public Petitions Committee is probably the right vehicle. In fact, two petitions have almost come together to try and resolve that issue. So When I sit in that committee, it makes me really very proud that we have a system where ordinary people can bring their cases to us, which deeply affect people's everyday lives, yet it's a place where people can come and speak to people who have perceived powers, who can engage with people and actually try and help resolve those issues, but more importantly, even look at legislation and giving the government another opportunity to perhaps sometimes look at what legislation is currently in place and how sometimes it can be effective or ineffective, but it gives people an opportunity to make that point at a very, very high level, I think, and I think that's very important. But I think, end of the day, the most important aspect to me is, for example, the report by Spice has suggested that there's not going to be a lot of change in terms of what type of cases come to the Public Petitions Committee. And they also suggest that it's a certain element of the community that actually brings these cases forward in terms of their academic background, in the terms of the ability to have research and, in fact, writing petitions down. All that is well and good. But I think one of the things that is missing from the committee is the engagement with our minority communities. Very few have had the opportunity to engage with the Public Petitions Committee, and I think we need to do some work in that area. This is not meant in any way of anybody's criticism. It just means that there's an element that we need to engage with. So, Presiding Officer, to conclude, I would like to say that I'm really very happy and very proud to be serving on the committee. I think it does a wonderful job. I think everybody engaged in it are trying very hard. I wish all of us that we continue to serve the people in Scotland and make sure that people's hopes and aspirations can be met. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Now call on Angus MacDonald to be followed by John Wilson. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to contribute to this debate today, especially given the fact that there's been some negative coverage over the Public Petitions Committee in the media in recent months. However, it is heartening to know the review of the public petitions process found that people who petitioned the Scottish Parliament found it a positive experience. However, as the report suggests, there's always room for improvement. The committee's report highlights that more can be done to further strengthen the reputation of the petitions process through greater transparency and engagement. So the committee is already planning to increase engagement with the public at a pilot event next month, which will try to understand why certain demographics are underrepresented by asking people for their views about the system and whether it represents or is seen to present a barrier to their participation. Now, I'm sure we're all keen to ensure that this Parliament remains open and accessible to the people it represents. The public petitions process was intended to be one of the main mechanisms for achieving this, and we must continue to ensure that the petition system remains effective. While other legislators have contacted this Parliament to see how we conduct the petitions process here, there is, of course, an opportunity for us to look at how it's done elsewhere. For example, both the National Assembly for Wales and the UK Parliament publish information about proposals that are received but do not go on to be lodged as petitions. And, of course, we have seen calls for this information to be made public here in recent months. Our process for progressing petitions remains relatively simple when compared to processes in other parliaments in the UK, Europe and elsewhere. According to the review, the stipulation in other parliaments that petitions must include the names and email addresses of a certain amount of supporters or obtain a set number of signatures before they become admissible, such as in Canada, or eligible for a government response or debate, such as in the UK Parliament, it raises a barrier to participation that thankfully doesn't exist in Scotland, and we should be proud of that fact. However, the briefing also shows a much higher percentage of inadmissible petitions in Scotland than in Wales and Ireland, so there's a strong argument that would suggest measures should be introduced to increase transparency in the decision-making process. Now, that said, of the petitions that have been admissible, we've seen some successes, and some have already been mentioned this afternoon. The one that sticks in my mind as the most helpful was the petition and our subsequent inquiry into tackling child sexual exploitation in Scotland, which resulted in the Scottish Government announcing a strategic national action plan. We also had a petition calling for stronger NHS support for chronic pain sufferers, which led to the Scottish Government's announcement
of a new centre for chronic pain last year, which the former convener, Dave Stewart, mentioned earlier. And as the Minister referred to earlier, the successful petition to have the Tinker's Heart in Argyll recognised, restored and listed as a monument of national historic significance, despite significant resistance at the beginning from the landowner and Historic Scotland. There was also a petition by school pupils to have Wi-Fi on all CalMac ferries. However, that one's only been partially successful because any CalMac ferry that I've travelled on in the last few months didn't have Wi-Fi, although I believe the ferry the petitioners use between Oban and Barra does. So those school students must have a feeling of empowerment having secured Wi-Fi for at least the ferry users from their local community. Other petitions have resulted in successes such as bringing about better access to cancer drugs, lifting the cap on discretionary housing benefits for people affected by the bedroom tax, and even the Scots pine being designated as Scotland's national tree. So while the committee has had a number of successes, the committee report makes it clear that more can be done to further strengthen the reputation of the petitions process through greater transparency and engagement, which I, along with other members of the committee, will ensure is set out in the committee's legacy paper. Presiding officer, we have a petitions process that we can be proud of. Let's ensure it stays that way. Thank you.
Many thanks. Now call on John Wilson to be followed by Stuart Stevenson. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I also take great pleasure in speaking in this debate. I think I'm currently the longest serving member in the Petitions Committee with almost 8.5 years membership. Some would say that was a punishment, but I've said it's been a pleasure to serve on the committee. And I've also served in the committee under 5 conveners now, Frank McAveety in 2007, Rhoda Brancken took over, then David Stewart in this session of Parliament, John Pentland, and latterly Michael McMahon. And it has been interesting serving on the committee to see the petitions that come forward and the issues that we're faced with almost on a fortnightly basis. But this report follows on the previous reports that have been presented to the committee and to this Parliament. The one in 2006 by Christopher Calman, followed up by the 2009 report, which made a number of recommendations to the committee about how we should take forward their work. And I think the report that's been produced by Gareth James today also helps in that deliberation in terms of where this committee is moving forward. Other members have made reference to the petitions that we've heard and petitions we've dealt with, some of them successful, some of them less successful. And I can think of the drugs policy petitions that we've had before us. Members have mentioned the mesh implant petition, which has been successful in highlighting the issues for many women in Scotland. The register of interest for the members of the Scottish Judiciary, which still rumbles on and we hope to conclude fairly soon. But interestingly, the other ones, such as the St Margaret's of Scotland petition that came forward about hospice funding. Now, these petitions have been supported by local members. They've been supported by other MSPs who have came along to the committee to speak on behalf of the petitioners. And I think that's one of the values of this committee, is members do feel confident enough to come along and contribute. And they are welcomed in terms of their contributions to the debates that are before us in the committee, because it helps us understand not only the local issues, but also understand some of the issues that sometimes the petitioners can't always express. And I think in terms of the Tinker's Heart petition that members have made reference to, I'm sure Michael Russell would like to take, MSP, would like to take some of the credit for his support in terms of Jess Stirling's petition, but also the work that he's done behind the scenes on that petition. The majority of the petitions that we have heard as a committee, the petitioners have said they have been satisfied with the petitions process. The difficulty is, Presiding Officer, it's the petitions that are not heard in this session of Parliament. We heard in terms of the report, and it came up last summer when an investigative journalist, former member of the Public Petitions Committee and this Parliament, identified through an FOI that almost two-thirds of the submissions to go forward for petitions were not heard by the Petitions Committee. Give way to the convener, briefly.
Michael McMahon.
I thank John Wilson for taking an intervention. It really is just to clarify, it did not require an FOI request to get that information. It was a simple request by someone who had an interest in the subject. And I think it's wrong to try and create the impression that someone had to dig in to what the Petitions Committee did via an FOI to get something which the clerks made readily available simply on a request.
To Wilson.
Can I say that in relation to the discussion, and Mr McMahon was not a member of the committee at the time this was raised, the issue was raised at the committee because there was a surprise, I would say, amongst the majority of members, the number of petitions or the number of submissions that did not go forward formally to be heard by the committee. And given the time that I have left, Presiding Officer, I would like to say that I think it will be important when we go forward that we actually look at the socio-economic demographics of those who are making submissions, not those petitions that are successfully heard by the committee, but by those who come forward with a submission that they would like to see placed before the committee, so we can determine what level of support and assistance is required by people who want to make that important petition submission to the Parliament, so that we can actually identify and address some of the support needs that have been provided in the past but don't seem to be currently available to petitioners to go forward. I hope the Public Petitions Committee has every success in the future and future parliaments actually see the role and the value of the Petitions Committee and continue to support it in every way they can. Thank you very much indeed.
Many thanks. Now call on Stuart Stevenson, after which move to closing speeches.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and let me start by congratulating the Minister on his brevity. That allows much more time for the backbenchers to express their view on a committee that essentially is a creature of the backbenchers. He's not attached to a particular minister. It represents the people that we represent here in a way that no other committee does to the same extent. I've been here since 2001. From the very outset, I found myself engaged with the Public Petitions Committee, sitting alongside many of my constituents. And I can't think that a single one of them who's come here has been other than delighted with the opportunity to put their case to Parliament, if not always equally delighted with the outcome. Because, of course, when the Public Petitions Committee gets a case, the odds are it's a hard case. Everything else has been tried. They've come to Parliament as a last resort. Now, that's not universally true, but it's certainly true of many of the cases that there will be before us. Jackson Carlow talked about debates in this Parliament being pedestrian. A quick look at the dictionary showed that there are 41 alternative similar descriptions one could apply. We beat ourselves up an awful lot. But in the Petitions Committee, there's very lively debate and discussion, often initiated by the people who bring their concerns to that committee. So we should look at that as a model of what we can do. It is one way, but not the only way, in which our constituents can engage with us. We, of course, are not typical of the people of Scotland. We are captured and held hostage in Edinburgh for 3 days a week, 36 weeks a year, about a third of the year. So we are, to some extent, disconnected with the day-to-day concerns that constituents and others will bring to the Public Petitions Committee and to us in our surgeries, our correspondence, our websites, our Twitter feeds, and so on and so forth. Now, today's debate has focused on the people who bring petitions, and that's good, because there's always a danger when we're looking at some of our processes that we focus on our internal view of how they are successful in a parliamentary context, whereas the reality is that we have to look at this from an external view and say, how does this serve the people of Scotland? Now, the number of petitions in relation to the population of our country is absolutely infinitesimal. It's 3% of 1% of the population, just a tiny, tiny, tiny wee fraction. Most of my constituents, when I, having exhausted all other options, say, well, why don't we think about a petition at the Parliament? I was doing that only on Friday at a surgery. They've never heard of the petition system. And I think that will be true of the overwhelming majority of people in Scotland. So I think we're going to have to be more cute about how we open the doors and make people realise the doors of the Parliament are open. The role of the weekly newspaper, the role of the national daily press is much diminished from what it used to be. Perhaps there should be a weekly slot on one of the television programmes, even if it's on the local TV stations, which are now popping up all over Scotland. We should bid to get some space on there and bring forward what goes on. There's so much you could say about the committee, but I want to just end, Presiding Officer, with saying one particular thing about which there's been some reference, and that is the role of the clerks. Because I think we can't underestimate the value that the clerks' activities in helping people who approach the committee with an idea for a petition turn their idea into something that they can come before the committee and speak to with confidence, knowing that it's properly constructed, proposes something the Parliament can do. And I think it's entirely appropriate that we thank the clerks on behalf of the people of Scotland for the really superb work that they do. This is the most valuable committee in Parliament. Abolish Parliament if you wish, but keep this committee.
Thank you so much. And I now call on Jackson Carlow to wind up. 4 minutes, Mr. Carlow.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like just to develop the point that I made during my own earlier contribution about the way in which we might more effectively advertise the parliamentary petitions process to the wider community through members' newsletters. And what I find interesting is that the members of Parliament who are most enthusiastic about the parliamentary petitions committee and process are invariably those members who have sat on the parliamentary petitions committee at some point and have actually had first-hand experience of the work that it can actually do. Members queue up to have members' business debates in this Parliament on the three occasions each week that they can, without perhaps, I think, fully appreciating and realising the opportunity that is open to them through the parliamentary petitions process to represent an equally important issue in conjunction with a constituent, but in a way which potentially allows that petition or issue to be developed in more detail through the evidence session that takes place and the potential opportunities that are open to the committee thereafter to pursue the issue with ministers and other external bodies on their behalf. And so I think there is a huge benefit that has not yet really been realised by members in actually associating themselves far more directly with the opportunity to them as they represent their constituents that the parliamentary petitions process represents. Now, we have had some external meetings in the time I've been there, and with mixed success. We had a very successful session in Inverary on a lovely sunny afternoon, and lots of people came. I remember a very wet day in Dumfries, where it was perhaps slightly less rewarding in terms of the public engagement. I went to a workshop in Oban, at which tootled up on the train, and it took most of the day, and 15 people were scheduled to turn up and six, I think, actually did. I know that speaks volumes of my draw on the ballot in terms of the public communication of it. But it's very easy to say that the committee and the Parliament should do more to promote the process. What's interesting to me is that as and when we have, that isn't the same thing as seeing the engagement that we might have desired coming from it. Finally, I'd just like to talk about the definition of success. The definition of success in a petition is not necessarily that everything the petitioner looked for happened, because in many cases the issue itself is then picked up by ministers or by other agencies, and the petitioner continues to be engaged in the process of that issue being taken forward long after the petition has been closed. And it's true, Joe Fitzpatrick mentioned Tinker's heart petition, Dave Stewart, the chronic pain petition, Hanzala Malik, Mr. and Mrs. Mundell, and the farming petition, and Angus MacDonald, the child sex exploitation one. And of course, I think several members also referred to Lord Gill. But I must say to Dave Stewart, I don't know whether he's aware of the fact, but it is the case that Lord Gill generously deigned to grace us with his noble presence eventually and did come before the committee and offer by way of a justification and explanation his view of the matter which we had tried so long and hard to encourage him to do. So it's not just that the ultimate aim is achieved, it's very often that the underlying issue has been pursued in a way that I don't think otherwise would have been, and in a way which I think is a great credit to the Parliament. And I would say to members who are elected in the next session, to understand the potential that the Public Petitions Committee offers to them to represent their constituents' best interests, and not just the floor of this chamber or the other more traditional committees.
Hey, thanks. Now call on David Stewart. 6 minutes, please, Mr Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think it's been an excellent debate. Lots of consensus, and I'm grateful for Jackson Carlo updating me about Lord Gill. I had missed the fact that Lord Gill had been before the committee. Obviously, it was something I said, Presiding Officer, that he didn't wish to come when I was convener. But in fairness, I did meet him with one member, so I would just put that on the record. I mean, I think if I could summarise Jackson Carlo's arguments is that he was very much a champion for the committee. It seems to me that everyone who's spoken in the Parliament today has effectively been a champion for the Petitions Committee, whether they're still current members or not, to pursue the issue at heart. And in theory, of course, Presiding Officer, all committees are there to keep the executive in check, but I think the Petitions Committee in particular has done that particularly well. And I'd like to put on record particular thanks to Nigel Dawn, who did make an intervention earlier. Certainly in my time as convener, Mr Dawn was a sort of honorary member of the committee because he appeared so often before it, talking about a very memorable junction in Aberdeenshire, if I remember rightly, and I wish him every success with getting that through Transport to Scotland. And Kenny McCaskill, who was an important member of the committee as an ex-Cabinet Secretary, was a very effective member of Petitions Committee, talked about the important role of consensus. And a point I think that no one else mentioned was that local authorities have actually picked up the great work that the petitions system has carried out. And it was also interesting, I think, to note that national governments and parliaments from across the world certainly has visited our parliament to see how it operates. For example, the Welsh Assembly were very innovative approach that they've had. I think they learned quite a lot from the way we operated in this parliament as well. I think Kenny McCaskill made an important point that effectively many petitioners see the Petitions Committee as an operator of last resort, and we should always remember that. I think that's very, very important that we need to look at that. And I think Mr McCaskill also made the point about balancing meetings between the Parliament and this fortnightly cycle and getting out to particularly disadvantaged communities, which certainly was picked up, as John Wilson has said, in previous reports, that we really need to see the committee trying to do more outreach work. But I would make an honourable mention, I think, of the Parliament Day approach. I think the Presiding Officer has made, I think, some very innovative approaches there. And in my experience of the committee going to Western Isles was a great success. And certainly what I found worked was spending 3 or 4 days in advance of Parliament Day to make sure that we had petitions, as Angus McDonald mentioned, on Wi-Fi in CalMac to make sure there was a bit of demand, to then ensure that the petition day worked. And I think I would particularly mention having the reception at the end where over 200 people turned up, a cross-section of the community. I think that is really extremely good example of best practice. And Salam Alec made, I think, a very important point about the milk quota case in Agallan Butte, which I would certainly wholeheartedly support since I was heavily involved with that. But I think a very important point about more engagement with minority communities. And in fact, effectively, Angus McDonald made the same point because he said, we've got to look very carefully at underrepresented groups. We need to make sure that the principles of the Parliament about being open and accessible are pitched towards our committee as well. And I forgot, and I'm glad Angus McDonald was there to remind us, about the excellent work done by Bernardo's, who asked us to do a major inquiry into child sexual exploitation, which government, by and large, picked up all the recommendations. That was a lot of work for all the committee. And I would say that previous petition committees have also done fantastic work since 1999, but actually doing a major inquiry is something that we should all look at very carefully. Particular mention for John Wilson, who gets the Parliament's Long Service Award for being the longest serving committee member to date. And he made some interesting points about admissibility and looking at the social economic appraisal of prospective petitioners. I think I'm out of time, Presiding Officer. I always like to mention, of course, Stuart Stevenson talked about the committee being a creature of backbenchers and how we need a TV slot to advertise what we're doing. And I would also echo his comments about the great work that the clerks to the committee have carried out.
We still
out.
Have a minute and a half if you want.
And finally, I think this has been a very interesting debate, and I would endorse the conclusions of the independent inquiry into petitions. Keep up the good work. It's an excellent committee, and I fully endorse the comments being made to date. Thank you.
Many thanks. Many thanks. I now call on David Torrance to wind up the debate on behalf of the committee. And I think it's only important for me, also having sat on the committee myself, to remember the spirit of John McCallion, who was the first convener on a committee I sat on myself. And his pioneering spirit certainly took the committee forward. Anyway, enough from me, a self-indulgence. Mr Torrance, 8 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am pleased to close the debate on behalf of the committee. The importance of the petitions process is, I think, accepted across the chamber. It is a core part of meeting our founding principles, and interest in our process extends across the world. A willingness to learn from our experience of the operation of the process will keep the process at the forefront of good practice. The insights we gain through reviewing the system ensure that we don't lose sight of the wider picture and the value of the process in the public for Scotland. The Public Petitions Committee is unique within the Parliament in terms of the variety of subjects considered and that the subjects are determined by members of the public. The reasons for a petition being brought forward are similarly varied. What each petition and petitioner has in common is a basis in the design or delivery of public services in Scotland. Petitions can stem from the most tragic of circumstances. People are willing to come forward with sometimes a deeply personal stories and a commitment to make sure that others do not face the same difficulties that they have. We must have an equal commitment to hearing those stories and carrying out the scrutiny that can help find solutions. Petitioners who were interviewed for research were asked for a review of the purpose of the petitions process. One petitioner, Beth Morrison, has been to give the ordinary person a voice. To me, this has given me, my child, and other families that I represent a voice, a legitimate voice, because it is out there in the Parliament. It is out there. It is public's information. It's given me an outlet, and hopefully it will bring about real change. Research notes, as long as people are treated fairly, or perceive they have been treated fairly, the more trust they will have for political institutions, such as the Scottish Parliament, and the more willing they will be to accept political decisions, including those of the committee. Recognising this is important because of the petitions process is not one that can guarantee the outcomes that petitioners may desire. It would be misleading to suggest otherwise. We can guarantee is that every petition that is lodged will be given consideration by the Parliament, petitioners' views will be taken into account at every stage of consideration, and that petitioners will be informed of the progress throughout the process. A report recognises areas where we can do more. Actions that can be taken include better promotion of the process, so that people know it is there for them to use and that a Parliament will listen when they do. Looking into the future, the collection and use of high-quality data will help us maintain a robust process, demonstrate fairness, and know that all voices are being heard. There is a range of options for doing this, and our successor committee will have to adopt the new test practices. If the experience and knowledge we have gained in this session can be shared and used, I am confident that we will have an even stronger process in the years to come. However, speaking for the current committee, I am grateful to members for their contributions to this debate and glad that you have taken this opportunity to debate and discuss this meaningful way to enable us to take forward the recommendations into the next Parliament sessions. Yes.
Hanzala Malik.
Thank you very much for taking my intervention. I just wanted to run something past yourself because you've had a lot more experience than myself. What about the petitioners who've been unsuccessful? Do you think there's room for those unsuccessful cases to go through either members' business or even perhaps through motions that might help the process?
Mr. Torrance.
I thank Hanzala Malik for intervention. I would agree with him on that point, that petitioners who have brought petitions forward to the committee, who haven't been successful, there must be another route for them to go through the Parliament. Presiding Officer, I would also like to thank my fellow committee members, both past and present, for their contributions to the committee. Thanks must also be given to the support staff of this committee for their hard work and advice, which has been invaluable to members and many varied tasks that they undertake. Turning to debate, Presiding Officer, David Stewart, Jackson Carlow and John Wilson all mentioned the mesh petition and the success of it, but any of us who sat in that committee, it was one of the most emotional evidence sessions I've ever sat on, and not only for the petitioners, but for us who were there on the day. As Alec Mark mentioned about engagement with ethnic minorities or the lack of engagement by the Parliament and the Petitions Committee. And we need to look at that process to see if we could increase that engagement out there with groups we can't reach. John Wilson, can I congratulate you on being the longest service member of the committee? And Stuart Stevenson came up with a real novel way of how we could go out there and engage with the public by advertising on TV and see if we could reach more of the general public. It's maybe one that the public petitions committee could take on. Angus McDonald and Joe Fitzpatrick mentioned the Tinker's Heart, and I'll come to that in a minute, but Michael McMahon also mentioned about the quality of engagement and the visit to Inverary, which, presiding officer, for anybody there, was just one of these meetings that the whole public became engaged with the committee. And it's that I'm going to turn to just now. The meeting of the Public Petitions Committee, which took place in Inverary on September 2015, is an excellent example of how engagement with local communities and the Scottish Parliament can be beneficial. This allows people to feel that they're not only are they an integral part of the petitions process, but also that their contributions will be taken into account in determining a final outcome. It was heartening to see the 14th Public Petitions Committee meeting, which was held on a glorious day in Inverary, was well attended by members of the public, and the reaction of Jess Smith following her submission on the successful conclusion to the Tinker's Heart petition was indicative of just how important it is to members of the public to be made feel part of the whole process. During the question and answer session, Alan Reid, the former MP for Argyll and Bute, not only thanked the committee for coming to Inverary, but commented on the Westminster Parliament and committee system and how it could learn from the Scottish Parliament. The meeting and reaction of the public involved only serves to illustrate how advantageous such a process is, providing a positive experience for many communities and making them feel their voice has been heard and that their options are valued. It also shows the openness and willingness of the Scottish Parliament to engage with the public in their own backyard on issues which are important to them and will impact on their lives in some way. To conclude, Presiding Officer, I think the debate has highlighted the importance of the petitions process in raising issues of concern and acting as a gateway to wider engagement within the Parliament. It seems appropriate to close the debate, not in my words, but in those of a petitioner. Mr McLeod, who says, I have always been very engaged with Parliament, but I am definitely felt more enthused by Parliament. I feel it is a very good organisation. I didn't doubt it in the first place, but I just feel it's a really good organisation we've got. I haven't written to my MSPs on any issues for a while, but I definitely feel more confident about writing to parliamentarians. Thank you.
Many thanks. And that concludes the debate on the review of the public petitions process, and it's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 15281 in the name of Anne McTaggart on the National Galleries of Scotland Bill. I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And if you are ready, Mr McTaggart, I'd invite you to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the National Galleries of Scotland Bill Committee. 4 minutes, please, or thereby.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to open the final stage of the debate on the National Galleries of Scotland Bill. Before I talk about the bill, however, Presiding Officer, on behalf of the committee, I would like to pay tribute to Gareth Hoskins, the architect in charge of the galleries project, who sadly passed away on the 10th of January. Committee members were fortunate enough to meet with Gareth on our site visit to the National Galleries last September. We were most certainly impressed with both his expertise and enthusiasm for the project. And if the bill was to be passed today, the extended gallery will be a fitting tribute to the work and vision of Gareth Hoskins. And we would also like to share our thoughts there with the families at such a sad time. Presiding Officer, I would also like to thank the committee clerks for all their hard work and to my colleagues Fiona McLeod and Jean Urquhart, MSP, who helped to scrutinise the bill and everyone who gave evidence on it. As members will be aware, the Bill's purpose is to enable the building of an extension to the Scottish National Gallery building into a small area of land which currently forms part of the Princes Street Galleries. The project also includes a plan to include a new landscaped accessible public pathway and terrace at the garden level aimed at improving access between the gallery, the gardens, Princes Street, the Playfair steps and the Old Town. This new accessible pathway is to be particularly welcomed as it will not only improve disabled access, but it will also help ease congestion on what is a busy pedestrian route. The extension is required by the promoter of the bill, the Board of Trustees of the National Galleries of Scotland, who wish to expand and improve the design of the gallery in order to house the Scottish art collection in a more appropriate and accessible location. The current Scottish art collection is housed down two flights of stairs in a basement presently. When this bill was discussed at the first stage debate, the Cabinet Secretary mentioned that visitor numbers to the gallery in the past 10 years have increased by 30%, and in 2014 was a year of record attendance with almost 2 million visitors. Yet at present, less than 20% of visitors to the gallery actually get down to where the Scottish collection is situated. This is a great pity, given that the collection houses pieces of art by celebrated Scottish artists such as Sir Henry Raeburn and Sir David Wilkie, and looks after one of the world's finest collections of Western art. The refurbishment of the gallery would create three times the amount of space it currently devotes to the Scottish collection, and will also improve the circulation throughout the building. The extension would allow Scottish art to be showcased in a more prominent way in specially designed spaces with natural daylight and stunning views across the city. It is estimated that it could also attract an additional 400,000 visitors every year. As Liz Simpson MSP pointed out during the first stage debate, this has the potential for significant financial benefits to the economy, which will in turn give the gallery the ability to preserve both the collections and the gallery for generations to come. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the committee is fully supportive of the aims of the promoter to improve access to the Scottish art collection. The proposed improvements both to the gallery space and the surrounding area will give Scottish art the prominence it deserves and will enable it to be enjoyed by a wider audience. Therefore, Presiding Officer, I move that the Parliament agrees that the National Galleries of Scotland Bill be passed. Thank you.
Thanks. I now call on Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop to speak a generous 4 minutes, Ms Hislop.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It's only a few weeks since we last met in the Chamber to discuss the National Galleries of Scotland Bill, but let me again express my thanks, as I did at Stage 1, to Anne McTaggart, Convener of the National Galleries of Scotland Bill Committee, and to the other members of the Committee, Fiona MacLeod and Jean Eckert, for the work that they have carried out in examining this private bill. And let me also thank the National Galleries of Scotland and the City of Edinburgh Council for their valuable contributions, which have supported this process, and similarly for the input from the members in this chamber. I visited the Scottish National Gallery earlier this afternoon to see the annual display of Turner watercolours. I strongly recommend it. The works were bequeathed to the gallery by collector Henry Vaughan. They span Turner's career from his early topographical wash drawings to the atmospheric sketches of continental Europe from the 1830s and 40s. and it's a wonderful example of the quality of exhibition which the galleries present, and I would strongly recommend members visiting if they can. Indeed, our Cabinet finished slightly early, so I was delighted that both John Swinney and Richard Lockhead were able to visit the Turner exhibition. And I think it's very important that all our politicians, whether government ministers or backbenchers, actually do support and visit our galleries. I was particularly struck by the Heidelberg and the fantastic sky representation, very small, but it absolutely captures the grandeur and the atmosphere of Scotland. And while we enjoy the magnificent exhibitions, like the Turner exhibition at the galleries at present, we can look forward to the wonderful transformation the National Gallery project will deliver. I hope, Presiding Officer, that you also think, as indeed Amit Taggart has already contributed, that it is appropriate in this debate that we remember the architect for the National Gallery project, Gareth Hoskins, who died suddenly at the very young age of 48 on the 9th of January. And my thoughts are with his family at this very sad time. And with his passing, Scotland has lost one of its leading architects. His reputation is worldwide, and his contribution to Scottish architecture has been exceptional. And following his firm's 2011 transformation of the National Museum of Scotland, the visitor numbers more than doubled, and it became the most visited tourist attraction in the UK outside of London. And his work on the National Museum demonstrates both the great potential economic benefits of good design as a local and national tourist draw and its power to deliver immense cultural benefits. And the Bridge Arts Centre in Glasgow and the Culloden Visitor Centre are just two other examples of his natural talent and carefully honed expertise as a designer. Scotland continues to benefit from his talent through the legacy of the outstanding contribution that he has made to our built environment and culture. And Gareth designed the new home for the National Theatre of Scotland, which is being built in Glasgow as we speak. And the transformation of the National Gallery as one of his final projects will undoubtedly be a further fitting reminder of the man and his talent. Presiding Officer, the process for this bill has established that it is a necessary step to allow the transfer of land to the galleries and to allow the development at the Mound to take place. And at the debate on the 3rd of December, we rehearsed the effect of the transfer of the 5-metre strip of land in Princes Street Gardens to the galleries, both within the building and in terms of external public space. In the past 10 years, visitor numbers to the National Galleries of Scotland have nearly doubled, with now in 2015 being the first year in which the National Galleries of Scotland has achieved over 2 million visitors. The National Galleries count among the most popular museums in Europe. The newly refurbished galleries will attract an estimated additional 400,000 visitors and 770,000 digital audience interactions every year, with a tripling of the gallery space available to show Scotland's national school, presenting not just the great historical figures, but also 20th century art, including the Scottish colourists. And it's very striking the impact it will have in using space intelligently to free up the opportunities that they have to showcase the Scottish collection in particular. And by passing this bill, we will help the National Galleries of Scotland continue to deliver an international class visitor experience, bringing real benefit to Scotland, showing Scottish art in the high quality setting that these collections deserve. And for this reason, I am pleased, Presiding Officer, to support the committee's recommendation that the bill should be passed.
Many thanks. I now call on Claire Baker. 3 minutes, Ms. Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is a very brief debate this afternoon, but it's important as this piece of legislation will enable the National Gallery to move forward with its proposals to extend the exhibition space of the gallery, make it much more accessible and improve the diversity of its offer. I'm pleased to contribute to the debate this afternoon, and I'd like to thank the committee members for their work, as well as the National Galleries and Edinburgh City Council. I'd also like to associate myself and Scottish Labour with the tributes to Gareth Hoskins and the Cabinet Secretary's words on his career and his legacy. Stage one was a brief debate, but it did allow us to reflect on the importance of the national collections, not just for Edinburgh and Scotland, but for our international reputation and attraction. National collections are important for reflecting the significance of art to a country. They are part of the cultural fabric of a nation, and they are a showcase to the world. The National Gallery of Scotland holds an impressive collection of Renaissance paintings and work up to the 1900s. The National Gallery is part of the National Galleries of Scotland Group, including the Portrait Gallery and the Modern Art Gallery. There have been many new acquisitions for the galleries over the years, most recently a portrait of the 18th century Scottish merchant David Scott, which is displayed in the Portrait Gallery after cleaning and conservation work. As well as a piece of art, it is also a piece of history and helps to tell our story of Scotland's long-standing links with India. Our National Gallery contributes so much to Edinburgh, situated in the heart of the city and frequently used by people who live, study and work here. It is an appropriate time of the year to be discussing the National Gallery with its unique Turner exhibition currently on display. The National Collections are also expanding their online offer with more of the collection available online with resource materials. Last year, BBC Scotland presented the story of Scottish art, exploring the key works and artists who have shaped Scottish art over the centuries. And if this new development progresses as planned, it gives the gallery an opportunity to provide access to more of its collection. The gallery hosts the world's largest collection of Scottish art, including works by David Wilkie, Alan Ramsay, William MacTaggart, James Guthrie and Henley Raeburn. As I said in the last debate, I hope more can be done to present women artists. I very much welcome the Modern Scottish Women exhibition, which is on at the National Gallery, but this is an exhibition which charges an entrance fee. And I hope the extension in the gallery space will allow greater opportunity to display the work of women artists and make them more accessible. The extension of gallery space will triple the available space for the Scottish collection, and I welcome efforts by the National Gallery to explore ways to offer greater access to Scottish art. Importantly, the additional space will also give more opportunities for research and conservation work. And the National Galleries have a duty of care for the collections and employ a team of conservationists. And the gallery's collection also includes important archives and libraries which are used by staff and visiting researchers. The National Gallery first extended its footprint in 2004 when the Playfair project was completed. Prince's Street Gardens are integral to Edinburgh and need to be protected, but these proposed developments do appear sensitive, improving the landscape around the gallery and providing more connectivity between Prince's Street and the Royal Mile will bring benefits for visitors, the gallery and the centre of Edinburgh, and I wish the project well in its development.
Thank you. I now call on Liz Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I immediately associate myself with the remarks of previous speakers about Gareth Hoskins. As a Governor of George Watson's College, I knew Gareth very well, and the Cabinet Secretary is quite rightly to say just how much of a loss he will be in the field of architecture, but so many other things in culture, and I think the legacy of this will be a fitting tribute to somebody who was a real inspiration in Scotland. Presiding Officer, could I also, like other members, thank the committee and the clerks for all the work on this. And just like stage one, can I reiterate that the Conservatives will be very firm in their support this evening. It's hard to believe that it is just 10 years since the completion of the National Galleries of Scotland Playfair project, which was a significant development in its time, because they transformed the presence on the mound and demonstrated the commitment to the preservation and enhancement of access to art and culture. So the fact that more than a decade later, we should again lodge a private members' bill which seeks to triple the size of the gallery to showcase Scottish art displays their very continued commitment to these aims, and I think we can all hope that Edinburgh will soon have an exhibition of Scotland's national art to compete with many international cities, including London, Paris, New York. Let's not forget the other benefits of this project. Although the galleries already managed to increase the visitor numbers, as the Cabinet Secretary has referred to, a further expansion will obviously bring discrete economic and social and tourist benefits. And of course, there is also the additional success that will be Prince's Street Gardens, including better disabled access, which I think is very important, and the landscaping around the area where the gardens and galleries meet will, I think, ensure that we are very privileged in our busy capital city to have that excellent green space. I think one of the successes of this bill is to take what was obviously going to be a very difficult legal issue, potentially, if we went down some of the aspects of the 1991 Act, that could have led to unnecessary complexity and great difficulty. So I think all credit to the Scottish Government, to Edinburgh City Council and to the National Galleries themselves. They've managed to bring forward legislation that has made it much easier for this project to be successful. And I think in doing so, actually, it has brought everybody together so that we can really celebrate and take pride in something that I think is going to be very important indeed for future generations. So I compliment all the stakeholders who've been involved in this. I greatly look forward to the time when it will be ready in 2018. And in the meantime, I look forward to hearing all about the and seeing the Turner exhibition, which I've heard so much about. It sounds really special. So I'm very happy to pledge the Conservative support for this bill this afternoon.
Thank you. Jean Urquhart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm also pleased to speak in this debate and can endorse everything that's been said by everyone so far. There are often alarm bells ring when any mention is made of a transfer of public land, but in this occasion, public land very definitely is being transferred in the public interest. Others have, in fact, everyone, I think, has made reference to the better access to the gallery's Scottish collection of paintings and the art. And while I welcome this, I think it's important that we recognise that actually what it does is extend the gallery to have better access to some of its spaces. And while I do welcome much mention of the Scottish collection, which I too love, it has been in the basement for a very long time in our country's National Gallery. And I do hope that one day the better access might be to see another collection in the basement and that we will see the Scottish paintings hanging in the main hall in our National Gallery at some time in the future. But this does allow that to happen. The small extension with Gareth Hoskins' beautiful design and his enthusiasm for this particular job of work was very evident when we met with him. And I too share others in their condolences to his family. But in addition to the improvements for the gallery itself, I think the better positioning of the memorial to those folk who went from Scotland to fight in the Spanish Civil War, which is at the moment kind of tucked away in the corner of this piece of ground and under the Playfair steps, will be given more prominence. And access to the famous Playfair steps, and generally an improvement to the whole area around that part of Princes Street Gardens. So it is a transfer of public land. The process has been fairly complicated, but I do thank the other two members of the committee, and I've been pleased to be part of that, that it's been a very interesting exercise altogether, and nothing, I think, but positive comments have been made in this particular proposal. So I look forward to seeing the work being completed. Thank you.
I now call on Fiona McLeod to wind up the debate. I would appreciate it, Ms. McLeod, if you could continue until 4:59.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In beginning, as the Deputy Convener, to close this debate, can I echo the Convener's thanks to our clerks, to the members of the committee, and also to the whole Parliament for their generous involvement in this process. Parliament will remember that on the 3rd of December we held the preliminary stage debate. I can't forget that, it was my 58th birthday. But on that day, Parliament agreed, following the committee's preliminary stage report, which was published on the 13th of November, on that day in December, Parliament agreed to the two items that they have to do in the public bill stages. And that was to approve the general principles of the bill and that the bill should proceed as a private bill. And we had a very interesting debate that day with contributions across the chamber. We then, of course, moved into the consideration stage of the bill, and the committee met on the 15th of December last year. And at a consideration stage, you have to look at two main processes. That is, are there any objections to the bill, and are there any amendments to the bill? And on the 15th of December, there were no objections or amendments to the bill. But if you can look at, perhaps it would be interesting for the Chamber to understand that part of a private bill, because when you're looking at objections, you want to hear the views of the public and any objections they have. So you ensure through a private bill that you have allowed the public to be able to contribute their views and any objections. The promoters set out a call for views and objections when they started to look at producing this bill. And then, of course, once the bill was introduced to Parliament, the committee sends out a call to hear views and objections. This committee went, I think, above and beyond the call of duty in that respect, because over 60 days over the summer, we had a call out for any views and objections and received no objections at all. And any views we received were in support of the bill as a private bill and also its general principles. The committee then went further, and in September, when we sat as a committee to start looking at the bill, we went on a site visit to see the National Gallery to meet the architect Gareth Hoskins, and as everybody has said, quite rightly pays tribute to his work, especially on this extension. But when we were at the National Galleries that day, we recorded a video so that again we could put out to the public, this is what the private bill's about, and we do hope that if anybody has views or objections, they will contribute to the process. But yet again, the only views that were expressed were support, no objections were found. So we find ourselves today at the final stage of the private bill. Today we have to consider any further amendments. There were no further amendments. So with that, Presiding Officer, I think I would again like to say thank you to all the members who have taken part in today's debate and also in the debate we had on the 3rd of September. I think the only one, it's invidious to pick out Andy, but I must mention Claire Baker, because she, of course, talked about the opportunities the extension will give in terms of the archive, the research, the conservation, but for me, of course, the library that's housed in the National Galleries Bill. So at that stage, Presiding Officer, it is for me to say, as the convener did, I hope that tonight at decision time that Parliament will agree that the National Gallery of Scotland Bill be passed. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McLeod. I'm sure we were all grateful for the explanation of how private bills in general work and how the National Galleries of Scotland Bill has proceeded through the Parliament. So the next item of business is consideration of motion number 15344 in the name of Alex Neil. On the Welfare Reform and Work Bill UK legislation, I call on Alex Neil to move the motion.
Formally moved, Presiding Officer.
Question this motion will be put decision time. The next item of business is consideration of a Parliamentary Bureau motion. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 15350 on committee membership.
Formally moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Fitzpatrick. The question on this motion will be put at decision time, to which we now come. There are five questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is at motion number 15144 in the name of Margaret Mitchell on the Apologies Scotland Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to and the Apologies Scotland Bill is passed. The next question is at motion number 15343 in the name of Michael McMahon on a review of the public petitions process be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is at motion number 15281 in the name of Anne McTaggart on the National Galleries of Scotland Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to and the National Galleries of Scotland Bill is passed. The next question is at motion number 15344 in the name of Alex Neil on the Welfare Reform and Work Bill UK legislation be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is at motion number 15350 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on committee membership be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. We now move to members' business. Members who leave the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.